Hello guys, here's level up session 49 with John Park. Hey man.
Hey, what's up guys?
Hey, nice, nice. We are here with Jonas De Ro, Wojtek and me, Darek. Hey guys.
Hey.
And today we have a great guest. John is like a beautiful concept artist that worked for Godzilla, for Transformers, for Lone Ranger, and a lot of beautiful, you know, project that he made, awesome concepts. And today he's going to tell us a little bit about his road as a concept artist, how have he started, and what's the breakthrough for him as into an industry. We also expect some, you know, some demo from him, but we will see how the time will go. So yeah, Wojtek is showing you his beautiful work right now.
When I see it, I cry every time, literally. I refresh my Facebook. And you were doing a lot of those recently.
I think we're all crying on Facebook.
Yeah, that's true.
I'm crying too. and the tissues that are around me, they're not happy tissues. They're sad tissues.
Of course, they're sad tissues. God damn it. Yeah, and you're part of my cry. God, you are so beautiful, John.
You are the reason, John, you know?
That's awesome.
Well guys, first off, I'd like to thank you guys for inviting me on this session of Level Up. I've been listening to you guys for quite some time, and the artists you guys have been interviewing have been really just awesome.
Yeah, very generous. Yeah.
Yeah. Awesome. And I was mentioning before, I was like, dude, this is really cool, just that the fact that, you know, there's an open community and we're able to have open dialogue and just talk. Because, you know, the art world is very, it's very kind of in its own bubble. And everyone's very, you know, they're either introverted or they're very shy.
Yeah, that's true.
And, you know, that's what it takes being an artist, right? Because you're kind of in your own world. And it's just great to hear, like, what other people have been through, educationally, personally, and, you know, professionally. So, I'm just glad that I'm able to share my story. And
this series is just amazing. What Wojtek just already shows us. It's like keep on going, dude.
All right.
Keep on killing us.
Well, I guess I can talk a little bit about my background then.
That would be great. Yeah. So you have you prepared any sort of your backstory, right? We were talking about this before. Okay, so if you can switch to your screen, if you have any artworks you want to show us from the past, or any visuals that you want to attach to the story, that would be awesome.
Yeah.
And guys, I've been showing the pieces that are present on John's Facebook. So if you like those, and of course you do, then go to Facebook and follow John. I will post his profile to the Facebook event. If you are watching it after the session, I will attach it to the YouTube video description as well, so you can find it.
So the screen is already on yours, John, so you can just go ahead.
Okay. Yeah, great. So the stuff that's on my screen, these aren't, like, they're not the oldest scans, but this is just what I was able to find on my computer. But, you know, long story short, I was drawing all throughout, you know, middle school, high school, and I think many of you guys share the same story. You know, I didn't really get into art or thought it was a real profession until after I graduated high school. It was quite depressing because, you know, I'm an Asian guy, right? I'm Korean American born. I was born in California, and so all Asian parents, and I speak for the Asian community. The parents put so much pressure on their kids to be these academic geniuses, right? And I was the complete opposite. I was like kind of retarded. I was horrible in English. I mean, I can speak it, but I was just horrible in like just all my English classes. I was probably one of the worst math students. You know, the best grades I ever got was maybe a C+. So my GPA average was like just, you know, was shot, you know, and I had all these, I was just surrounded by all these, like, these other guys that just were fucking smart. And so, wait, are we allowed to cuss on this podcast or this session?
Are we what? Again?
Like, if I use the F word, is that like a bad thing?
Yeah, go ahead. Fuck, shit, bitch, whatever. It doesn't matter.
All right, well, I'll try to keep it. I'll try to keep it.
No. Just no. Just the way you are, man.
Feel free to.
Be yourself. Be yourself.
Yeah. But yeah, like it was a thing where I was, as an artist, I was just trying to figure out like what I wanted to do with kind of my life. And I remember talking to a counselor when I was in high school, and he was just like, John, I don't know what you're gonna do with your life, but you better figure it out. And because my grades were bad, and you know, I never really thought of going to a real college was for me. And so, you know, after I graduated, all my friends went to these awesome colleges, right? Like, you know, UCLA, Berkeley, these very prestigious colleges to become something relevant. And, you know, all I had was just my sketchbooks, you know, like my little doodles that I had on the side of my homework. And it wasn't until I came across Art Center, and I heard about it through actually my brother, who went there for product design. And so I thought I was like, dude, this is an awesome opportunity for me to, you know, kind of get into something that I'm familiar with. And so I, instead of going straight into Art Center from high school, I took some time off and I went to a community college, which is kind of like going to 13th grade. It's not like real college. And I was just taking Art 101 and all these weird classes, man. It was just a bizarre experience.
That was your introduction to art, actually.
Yeah, that was my introduction to art. I had one art teacher who, he was an awesome person, but he was like the worst teacher. I did a drawing and I accidentally creased the corner of my paper. You know, like if this is like 8.5 by 11 and you accidentally crease the corner by putting it into your backpack, he was more excited about that crease than my actual artwork.
Oh, no.
It was confusing. He was like, this is the best crease. It says so much about your artwork and your personality and everything. And I was like, what is this guy talking about, man? Like, dude, I'm here to learn how to draw. And it was just really confusing. So I started like kind of looking into, I was just thinking to myself, like, dude, I need to go to Art Center, like, now, dude. I need to really try to learn what these other guys are doing. And like, you know, that's when like Gnomon, they released like the Gnomon DVDs. I picked up the Skillful Huntsman that was published by Design Studio Press.
Yeah, I have this one.
And
as well.
You know, and they start to, then those things start to become kind of like your world, right? And they were kind of my bread and butter at the time because I had no other sources. So after 2.5 years of community college, I finally had the portfolio ready to go into Art Center, and I got accepted as not as illustration but as a product design major. And so I'll show you some of my product stuff. These are just kind of miscellaneous sketches, but it's my first Photoshop painting right here.
Nice.
here's some product stuff. At Art Center, it's a little funky. It's like they want you to go into product and transportation. So for those of you guys who don't know, like what product design major is, it's just basically industrial design. So this is one of my older first product assignments at Art Center. Let me try to go to the first page. So, like, the goal was we had to design a pull toy, right? And a pull toy is basically for, like, little toddlers, uh-huh. And they had to kind of have, like, you know, something that's ergonomic, something that's made out of wood, it's friendly, and I decided to do, you know, this pull toy. And, you know, we always start with, you know, your inspiration. So my inspiration was a flatfish. And, you know, what about a flatfish that I like the characteristics were, you know, locomotion, adaptability and the shape, right? So we always had to create these like mood boards before getting into the drawing and all the cool fun stuff. And then they always made us do like these materialists. And you know, this was all part of the process of like designing and stuff like that. And so like, you know, obviously like what I'm showing you guys, this is kind of like after I've been at Art Center for a little while. So like, going in, I didn't have like this kind of, you know, research all set up. But it taught me a lot about, you know, think before you draw and, you know, like, or plan before you design. And so these things were very essential, and they're kind of the foundation for how I just kind of go about art. And so this was just kind of like in a nutshell. It's like flat fish, there's patterns, and it's made of wood, right? And so that's when we went into the drawing phase, and our instructors wanted just to see a bunch of ideas. And like many, like how we all work in the film and game industry, you know, you just want to see a broad range of ideas. And so this is initially how I was like conceptualizing or thinking about different toy ideas, thinking about like, you know, what if there's like one wheel or two wheels and there's like this kind of range of motion? What if it was inspired by jellyfish or squid or turtles? And it was just all about exploration, right? And what was really cool about product was they didn't necessarily care about like how well you necessarily drew, but it was just more about your ideas. So, you know, like they just wanted to see a bunch of like, you know, cool, just little sketches and ideas. And so, like this was kind of like my education for the first year at Art Center. And then this was like more getting into it. And eventually, you know, I started kind of settling on this idea of like a flatfish. Mm-hmm. And then that led to, you know, really figuring out like all the different mechanics and kind of like getting into like the nitty gritty of the design, right? And so, you know, this whole process taught me a lot about just, okay, cool, I'm doing a lot of research and thinking. But I still wasn't happy with my education as a product student, because I felt like I wanted to draw, you know, what I grew up watching and playing games, and I really wanted to get into the film and video game industry, which is entertainment at the time. So, you know, after this project, then I started kind of you know, still doing my sketches on the side. And I really had the urge of like wanting to get into, you know, like the robots and stuff, right? So stuff, yeah, like this.
The fun part, right?
And yeah, like this was like something that I always, you know, how do I make that leap, right? How do I do like what all those awesome other guys are doing, like, you know, like Ryan Church, you know, Scott Robertson, and all those guys that, you know, I was looking up to at the time. I always wanted to do what they were doing, but how to get there was still really ambiguous. There wasn't like really a track. And, you know, I think we all have a similarity where you have to find your way. You have to find your own education. And so, let me see here. I guess I can go into...
So, how many years ago it was exactly, if you can tell us?
I started Art Center in 2006. Mm-hmm. And then I basically left school at the end of 2009. So I was there for maybe like 3 years at most.
Okay.
So my first year I was you know, I went in as product and transportation design, so I knew how to do was like cars, and I knew how to draw pull toys, those little fishy things. So that was the extent of like my education, I feel like. But you know, like it just still like dawned on me, I was like, oh man, how do I get into like doing those cool environments, those like awesome robots and all that stuff, like, cuz you know, product, they didn't have anything like that. And then they didn't have, you know, at Art Center, they didn't have a entertainment, you know, major, it was still like kind of, you know, random miscellaneous classes. So it's like I felt like you had to customize your own education, right?
Yeah.
And so Scott Robertson was actually teaching a perspective class. Dude, that was like the best experience like I've ever had, because he was like, his DVD and his book were one of the first books that I bought, and to just kind of meet him in person and to learn from him was just an awesome opportunity, and I'll be sure to kind of show some of the work I did in this class.
Yeah, it's awesome.
Let's see here. I kind of skipped through this. Sorry, guys. My presentation's a little like unorganized. So he taught perspective, right? And he always did these awesome spaceship drawings. And I was just like, dude, this is it, man. This is the answer. And all I wanted to do was this. It's just like spaceships and on these grids and these lines, right? So I felt like Scott Robertson and Feng Zhu were like the masters of this.
True.
And around this time, this is where I first met Ben Morrow. He was like one of my first art friends that had the same interests. Uh-huh. But Ben was way awesomer than I was. He was like,
what does this mean?
he was basically like, I felt like I was like a freshman and he was like a senior, or I felt like I was like level one and he was like level, you know, 50. I was like, oh my god, I want that armor. I want the armor that he has.
Yeah.
So awesome. So I got to meet Ben through a mutual friend, and Scott Robertson actually was going to offer us an internship. And basically, Ben and I, that's like our first time interacting and getting to work together, and we actually got to work on this project called Mas Macho, and it was basically about like this Hispanic Batman, right? So okay. This guy is about like, he goes and he fights crime using peppers and like jalapenos, and he throws like beans and rice at you, right? So he always had these weapons, and it was such a funny idea. But you know, that's like when I was working on this, I was just so nervous because, you know, it was with Scott and Ben, and they had such great work. And some of this work right here is some of these sketches are Ben's sketches. That one's Ben's right here, and it was a liberating experience because, you know, you got these guys. Who you've kind of, you really admire their work, and you get an insight on how they think, how they draw, mm-hmm. how they design, and it was just like, I felt like this was kind of the start of my education. Mm-hmm. So I was really fortunate again, like to be around guys like Ben Morrow, Scott Robertson when I first started Art Center, and it was just kind of like the light at the end of the tunnel, you know. I was just like, I felt like I was finally reaching that point. And it was just like, it was an awesome 3 months. I was at Design Studio Press, and it was just all three of us. We were just drawing 8 hours a day, you know, 5 days a week. Ben and I, we would meet up on the weekends to do extra work. And we come up with ideas like this, like big belly shooting, you know, jalapeno out of his belly, out of his tummy, and just like coming up with weird ideas and just weird just concepts, you know. And it was just drawing. Everything was all about drawing. I didn't officially get into Photoshop until maybe 2008, so I was limited to just like, okay, paper and pencil.
Or maybe not limited, but the other way around. You know, sometimes you get more limited by using digital media than actual pen and pencil, I guess. Yeah, sometimes it feels more limiting, I think.
Yeah, that's true. I mean, you know, they say like you're the most creative when you have like these boundaries or these restrictions, right? Because then you start to think more, or you start to like think outside the box. So yeah, we just did like tons of these sketches, and you know, Ben was like, he was like one of the best painters, and he still is, in my opinion. one of the best illustrators and designers that I had the pleasure of working with. And just watching him draw and paint, I was just like, what? Dude, this guy is such a beast. I need to learn from this guy. But again, like, you know, he didn't know me, I didn't know him, so it was hard to, like, you know, share idea or share, you know, share techniques and stuff. And mm-hmm. so, you know, once we start to sketch and work together, we started exchanging, you know. He wanted to know more about, like, the way I sketched, and I wanted to know more about the way he painted, and it was just such a great like fellowship and like
exchange.
Just like a balance. Mm-hmm. And Scott, he was always like kind of the like the mentor slash dad that we had, you know, like always looking over our shoulders, always making sure we were doing the right thing, and it was just an amazing experience. Like I every day, I was just like I couldn't believe it, you know. And there's some days where you kind of like you kind of take for granted for what you experience, and you just gotta like look back and think about like, wow, this was just an amazing experience. So yeah, just going through the motions of like just drawing, and being able to like be with these guys was great.
A lot of the things like dynamic pose and everything that you've been doing, you know, with your pencil, it's quite easy to notice in your digital pictures, which is very good because, you know.
Oh, thanks, man.
Because, you know, people sometimes tend to do maybe less dynamic pictures than on the paper, but you still keep them managing it with your pew-pew session series. and yeah, it's some of the, you know, the forms, the pose is very similar. Yeah.
I love the stylization and gesture.
Yeah. Get things. Oh, thank you. Showing up.
Yeah, because the legacy is still in the digital painting that you know, it's something that you learned in the past with doing it on paper. So.
Yeah, you know what's funny was I thought painting and drawing were two separate things. And it actually really scared me to get into painting because I was like, oh man, I don't think I'll have the control. But later I learned, like, you know, someone once said, like, you know, the way you draw is the way you paint, right? And then the way you paint is the way you draw.
Yeah.
So it's like you gotta have such a strong foundation of drawing to have a good painting. Yeah, and it works the other way around. You gotta have a strong foundation of painting to have a really good drawing.
Yeah.
And you know. Yeah, like when you look at like all the other master painters and all the awesome like concept artists, you kind of wonder like, man, these guys can paint, but they can really draw and design just as well, you know.
Mm-hmm.
So it was something that like as I was, you know, continuing to paint, I was like, oh man, I gotta get better at drawing. I gotta understand anatomy better. This page here was Ben's. Ben was like, he was always rocking these awesome designs and. Keep in mind, guys, like, this stuff was on 8.5 by 11. So we were drawing, like, super tiny.
Yeah.
It was awesome, dude. It's just like, busting out these cool little sketches.
You have tons of them here.
Yeah, dude, I think we spent, like, a couple, like, 2, maybe 3 months drawing just a bunch of these.
Awesome.
We have, like, probably a couple hundred pages of drawings. I'll get to some of the next sets.
There are some comments in the chat going on like people would love to see it as a game or something.
I believe Scott he set this project for us. It was supposed to be like a development like pitch for a video game or like an animation series. So we had the opportunity of designing like characters, vehicles, props, you know, environments, like the whole thing.
Mm-hmm.
And it was scary, but it was also very fun because, you know, you weren't just focused on one thing. And it was just such a challenge because, you know, I was so used to just doing, you know, drawing like vehicles or props, and, you know, being able to draw like characters was a challenge. Being able to do environments was a challenge, and Everything was like a process, and everything was like a learning experience.
Yeah.
These cars are awesome.
These cars, yeah. These like super junky cars.
Yeah, transformed into like weapons and stuff. So good.
Oh man, I lost my train of thought. I was gonna say. So one of the things I'd love to share with you guys and everyone that's listening to this session is more about kind of my education and like what I learned, because as far as like my professional work experience goes, I'm still fairly new to the industry. You know, I've probably been working maybe 5, maybe 6 years professionally, but I still feel like a student, you know, and I'm sure everyone still feels like a student at a certain point. But I was really I feel like my educational years were kind of the pillars of where I stand today, right? They're kind of like the foundation, and they're basically everything and anything that I know. So I'm such a huge sucker for, you know, ideation. I love ideas. I just love, you know, just coming up with sketches. It's a lot, mainly because I'm afraid to commit or afraid to do a painting, you know, and it was just my excuse of saying like, oh, I just want to just do a bunch of design ideas, and then I'll try to worry about the painting later. But eventually, you know, working with Scott and Ben, they kind of boosted my confidence, and they were able to kind of help me through the process and help me kind of illustrate and execute one of my ideas.
Mm-hmm.
And so this was for a book called Alien Race, and this arrangement is just a bunch of ideations and like quick, like just sketches, you know, showing different ideas, and then we would choose one or two of them and then just illustrate them or paint them.
Mm-hmm. Nice.
To convey color, texture, just the lighting, and just to kind of really bring this to life. And this was just like, you know, a lot of this was inspired by looking at, you know, Scott's and Ben's, and I believe at the time Tom Tenery, Peter Chan, and Justin Pichet Rungzi. These guys were kind of the main authors for this book. And if you guys haven't checked out Alien Race, from Design Studio Press, I highly recommend you guys checking out that book, because those other guys did so much cool stuff.
Yeah, I remember Scott mentioning it in one of his generating ideas talks when he used like a photo booth from to generate aliens' heads by using
Yeah.
a photo booth. That was really creative. I loved
Yeah,
it.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah,
it was such a cool, like, he's always pushing the boundaries. It's nuts. And you know, me and Ben, we're just on the sidelines, like trying to like soak in as much stuff as we can. And so let me see if we can go through that stuff here. Let's see here. Again, like just more sketches. You know, it's all about just kind of the ideas. It's all about, you know, start from broad and then get into specifics, right? So, you know, on the top column, these were just kind of like the smaller sketches, thinking about proportion, thinking about the basic, you know, design feeling, and then getting more into, you know, the details here on the bottom. And then, mm-hmm. you know, this was actually a cool collaboration. I did the sketches, and then Ben took it, and he kind of like rendered it up, and he basically made it alive. This was like our first, like, you know, painting and drawing and designing collaboration. So this stuff here, this was the stuff that I think you were talking about, where we took like the photo booth stuff, and we basically mirrored it on Photoshop, or I think on his MacBook, and then we did a print screen, and then we basically painted on top. And it was just interesting play on like symmetry, because like you get these weird forms, and the whole goal was to come up with like really strange looking alien heads and faces. It's like they all kind of look like Sesame Street characters, right?
Yeah. So like, basically the process was, you take an object, right? You put the photo booth to symmetry mode, and you shoot an object. in a similar light condition, and you kind of make your hand disappear where you hold it, and it kind of sticks out from two places. And
I think I think this fat thing right here, this like weird guy, he was like a chicken or something. Then I think this might be like Ben's thumb or like or someone's hand that we like kind of created a fist.
Yeah. That's crazy.
Some of it starts to look really nasty, like, you know, you get like penis head or something. Or vagina face.
It gets
really disgusting fast. And then so we would basically take one of these head drawings, and then we would put it onto a body. Right? Mm-hmm. And it was just such an interesting way to work, because you're like, oh man, you're now you have like a base of a head. And I wonder what the rest of the body would look like. And it was just such a great way to kind of, you know, problem solve and design. Yeah, it's like kind of I don't know, like looking through like a little little peeking hole, and then like you zoom out, and then it's like boom, the environment, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, like the small piece can inspire the whole design.
Yeah. And here's some other creatures and stuff. We're like, we started with the head. I believe all of these are Scott's like alien head designs, and then I finished off the body.
Mm-hmm. Awesome.
So yeah, the whole aesthetic of this world was very like animation-y, like kind of fun, goofy style.
Yeah.
And it takes me to my next segment. As I was like, you know, learning about, you know, film and game design, I really came to fall in love with, you know, animation, and that's like the first thing I wanted to do actually. I actually wanted to get into, you know, DreamWorks and Pixar. I believe when I first watched you know, Toy Story, I was like, oh man, that's so cool. I love the world building. I love the characters. I love everything like about like all the aesthetics that they're doing. So this was a class project we did, and this was based. This was my version of Shrek. And let me actually bring up Shrek so it makes more sense. My concept was based on, you know, you have Shrek, you have the cat, and then you have the donkey, right?
Mm-hmm.
How to make them look interesting, I was thinking like, oh, it'd be cool if everything was based off of rock, paper, scissor. So Shrek would be the rock. He'd be like the very stubborn character design. He's not about change. He's very like, but he's a very strong character, and he stands his ground. And so the aesthetic of his face, like the design language, like the shapes and stuff would be very rigid, like a rock, right? All of my studies were kind of based on that, and I was trying to implement that into his body proportion, and trying to get that feeling and like, you know, that look, that he kind of has that like rock boulder type of aesthetic. And so these were just some more variations on that look, and like you can tell like his silhouette is literally just like a big rock or a big pebble, right?
Yeah, angularity and.
Nice.
There's so much character to it because of that. Just because you thought it out, like you pick the concept and you think, all right, this is what I'm going to stick to, because an idea works, and then you make it works visually because of that.
Yeah, I think conceptually it's like, you know, rock, paper, scissor. Everyone knows that game, and it's like a simple concept. And I wanted to, you know, because it's so simple, I think it's something that can be easily understood. And I know it's one of those things where it's like, you know, as a concept, you know, when you talk about it, it might not be exciting, but I almost find that, like, you know, if it's simple, you can make it, you have the opportunities of making it more exciting, right? You have that wiggle room of, you know, exploring more ideas. I struggle so much when I have to deal with like a personal project or a professional assignment where, you know, it's so complicated to begin with. I get so overwhelmed, and my brain doesn't like want to think. I'm just like, oh my god, I gotta look online. Let's see what let's see what conceptart.org has or CG Hub or ArtStation has. Like, I wonder, let's see, I wonder what these other guys like did for this assignment, you know? And so, it was a very like, I feel like there's always kind of that give and take. Let's see, but this character was a cat character, mm-hmm. and you know, the character was based off of scissors, so a lot of the shape was like, you know, it's like, okay, how do I make him look sharp and scissor-like?
Yeah, I love how like the shape of his head is so simple, but you made it work. I can say, like, I would love to see it as an animation. I just
thanks, man.
Actual expression just works, you know, with your character works. And overall, the presentation that you are showing us right now is like all about the versatility you have, which is awesome. Because you know, you tasted like the vehicles, the character design, the more stylized pictures. It's awesome.
Oh, thanks. I think honestly, like when I think about you know, subject matter, it's like if you can just apply, you know, like if you can think about like what you're drawing or what you're designing, mm-hmm. And you can really simplify the motives or the goal, it makes it a lot more approachable. It makes it a lot more less intimidating, right? Mm-hmm. Because I mean, to be honest, like I don't know anything about character design, but I do know how to, you know, come up with some ideas just based on doing maybe research or having keywords, and then I'll go from there, right? You know, when it comes to anatomy and stuff like that, I'm like, I get so overwhelmed. I'm like, okay, holy shoot, dude, the arm doesn't look right or whatnot. But you know, I'll take a step back and then I'll think about like, okay, what do arms really look like? And you know, what are some examples of like cartoon arms or cartoon anatomy? And how far do they push? And so, I think it's really simplifying kind of your method of approach makes it easier. It makes it more digestible and it makes it more approachable. And so, like, you know, a lot of the stuff, like, you know, obviously I'm showing everyone just kind of like these sketches. And you know, don't get me wrong, I'm not, you know, I don't do this from the start. I'm not like, it's not like, you know, this is like just pages and pages of messing up. And obviously I don't have that stuff scanned in, but you know, it took me a long time to get just this, right? Like just this drawing on the very bottom right. And this whole concept was Prince Charming and the Fairy Godmother. And it was about the concept of like, he's kind of like this spoiled brat who wears this party hat. And he always thinks it's his birthday, right? It's always his birthday. And he was like, it's my birthday. I want to make the decisions. And his fairy godmother is kind of acts like, it's kind of like a little party hat. So she's always on top of his head. So she's kind of the puppet master. And she's always giving him ideas and makes it think as if it's his own ideas. And so she's kind of the mastermind. She's always like right here, it kind of looks like a crown or a party hat, and she's like, let's go that way. And then his face is like, let's go that way.
Awesome.
That's awesome. but yeah, I mean, I think at this time, like, I you know, educationally, I really wanted to get into animation. And this is all I knew. I knew, like, oh man, Pixar, DreamWorks would be awesome. Disney would be a dream. And it wasn't until one of my friends asked me, he's one of my good friends, his name is Albert Ng. And he asked me, he was like, hey man, I always see you do animation stuff, but it'd be really cool if you tried, you know, doing like more video game live action work. And I was like, man, I don't think I've ever done anything like that. And so, you know, switching gears was also an interesting, like, interesting kind of journey where, you know, like, you know, if I did an environment, it would still feel really cartoony, and it was just understanding, like, you know, maybe I can straighten out the proportion, maybe I can look at look at aesthetics and not look at style, and you know, just kind of look and just kind of think about the overall, like.
This is beautiful. This one is amazing.
Oh, thank you. And yeah, like, I mean, this would be an example. Like, you know, there's still like some really like whimsical shapes here, but then, you know, how do we bring it to more of the realism of, like, you know, Call of Duty or some of those you know, more live action film type games. So that took me a long time to kind of, you know,
figure out.
Yeah, I think I was always used to doing like very, you know, whimsical ideas, and so I don't know what year this was, but this was for a project that I did with a friend. His name is Anthony Leonardi, and he's this like really talented director. And this was like one of his first. This is kind of his baby project, but it was about a world where these characters are kind of lost in this, like, in this. It's not heaven or hell. It's kind of like this weird void, and there's all these like old dreams that are kind of stuck in this world, and so everything is made up of like old dreams and old, like, you know, epic journeys, and that's kind of what makes the architecture.
That's great.
Oh man, this is like still when I was like, okay, animation, I wanted to do like a Peter Pan project, and so this was my version of Peter Pan and Hook, and these are like the three kids.
Nice.
Yeah, so you did a lot of redesigns of well-known tales and stuff. So once you did it for the school assignments, then you started doing it on your own, right?
Oh yeah, I mean, I think I would always, you know, it's like taking like existing IPs, like Peter Pan, right? Like, you know, growing with Peter, you know, I think a lot of people know the story of Peter Pan, but it's like you always think about like, oh man, it'd be cool if they had this, right? You always have this idea of like, oh, it'd be awesome if they fought on this kind of ship, or it'd be cool if, like, if, you know, Hook had not only a hook, but like this huge, huge sword that looked like from Final Fantasy or something. And so I think that's what makes us like concept artists, is that we have these abilities to be able to kind of, you know, show that off. And so I really wanted to do like my own version of Peter Pan. Let's see here. Sorry guys, it like kind of bounces around. I think I have like all this stuff.
No worries, man. It's awesome.
And I think this was for that same dream project.
Yeah.
But again, it's like, I think in this scene, it's about conveying just kind of the moment, and it's like I want it to be a screenshot of like what would it be like in the movie or something if they reached this weird grassy mound or something. And then there you go. That's Hook right there.
Nice.
He's so got good. Like a golden tooth.
Yeah.
And then on his chest,
yeah.
On his chest is like that music note where he would crank it and he would play like the same musical instrument.
Oh god, you figured it all out.
As he walks in. And then here's some I think these were some character designs I did with Scott and Ben Morrow. This was for like, it wasn't for Moss, that Mexican Batman project that I was showing you guys. This was like it was like another small project that we did afterwards, and it was based on like Greek mythology. And there's all these, like, you know, you have these heroes, different female characters, you know, wizards and stuff like that. So these are just kind of different character designs that I did for that project.
You did so many of them. That's so good. So good to see those. We cannot really find them online, right?
These ones, no, they're just kind of my drive.
Awesome. So we got an exclusive look into your past projects, which is just mind blowing. Yeah.
Level up premiere.
let's see what else. I can show you guys. So I guess I can talk about like what happened after school.
Yeah, that would be great.
So, I actually never got a chance to graduate Art Center. Fortunately, I had to leave after my third year. I got to meet really great artists like, you know, Ben Morrow, you know, Tom Tenery, Peter Chan, Justin, Petre Rungzi, like all these guys that are working today. I got to meet them, and I had to take a leave of absence because my family was going through some financial problems. Mm-hmm. So I had to basically leave school to basically find work. And because my parents, they used to own like a frame store, and it went bankrupt. And so, they had to sell their house and all this stuff. And so, like, you know, my parents were in a really tough situation. And so, you know, they were like, you know, son, you gotta, if you can leave school, that'd be awesome. If you can help us out for a little bit. And so, it was a really like emotional roller coaster that I kind of went through during my years at Art Center. And so today I stand before you. I'm like, I don't have a diploma at Art Center. I still have only my high school diploma. And I was fortunate enough to meet, you know, Scott Robertson. I got to meet James Paik,
yeah,
who's a concept artist, and he basically taught me everything about freelancing. He basically taught me everything about what it is to survive out in the world of, you know, working as an artist. And so he was basically my segue to understanding that part of the world, and he taught me how to paint environments. And so a lot of the paintings that I'm showing you, anything environment related, was basically, you know, a big thanks to him, because he kind of like paved that world for me. And you know, he really helped me, you know, kind of get my feet, you know, wet, and get me prepared to make that journey. This is like some earlier stuff. This was like, you know, I wasn't comfortable doing color work, so when I was working with James, he always advised me, like, you know, figure things out in black and white, because, you know, when you're working with pen or pencil, you know, we're so used to drawing on paper and pencil, like, the next best thing is working in value, right? So work everything in black and white and try to figure it out and make sure it reads. So I did this for about, like, a solid, I think I worked and painted this way for maybe, like, a good year before being comfortable getting into color. So, you know, like, yeah, I hope you guys aren't, like, deceived by some of the work I show you guys, because it's, like, it's not, you know, I honestly don't believe in talent. I really believe in hard work, you know. And I think,
yeah, that,
I think
that's
every...
that's a concept we bring up pretty often, and it's really interesting to see how many guests and really amazing artists repeat that over and over since they came through the same kind of a route.
Yeah.
And even if that's not the same route, this concept is the same, like, hard work.
Yeah, exactly. It's hard work. I mean, I think talent can be, it can be worded differently. I think, you know, we look at talent as like, oh, you know, he accomplished so much, you know, he did so much, therefore he's talented.
Because, yeah.
I really believe in, like, you know, passion, right? If you have the passion for it, you are talented, right? Mm-hmm. So I think everyone that's part of the art community, everyone is talented. Everyone is passionate. It's just a matter of, you know, are you willing to put the hours into it? And some people are more hungry than other people, and therefore they get there a lot quicker. But it doesn't mean that you have, you know, less passion. It just means, you know, those other guys are getting there quicker. And so, you know, when I got to meet, like, you know James Paik and these other great artists, like, I felt that they had the hunger. They were just so hungry and so excited to work and draw 8 hours, you know? And that's so crazy, dude. Sit there on a desk and draw and paint for 8 hours is nuts, right? But that's what it takes. That's what it takes to be an exceptional artist, to work in the film and game industry, to work in commercials, to work for theme parks, to work for animation.
Actually, there is no shortcut for it. If you don't sacrifice enough, it's like you don't get it, you know, that you really want to achieve. So it's like we can see right now, you are showing the huge amount of the difference, that the, you know, versatility in your work, that, that everything you tried and everything you tasted in your life, and you tried a lot of new things that, that helped to, you know, develop your skills, to evolve as an artist and be more conscious as a concept artist and came up with cool ideas. So
thanks, man. It sounds so cool. that's like the cool version. I felt like when I was doing these, I didn't know what I wanted, right? Yeah, I was just like, I felt like I was dating. Like, you date like different types of girls or something, or I felt like a kid at a candy store. It's like, I don't know what kind of candy, so I'm gonna try everything.
Exactly. Yeah, I had that feeling before. It was like, I know what I like, but I kind of like too many things at the same time. I like animation, like this, I like that, and you have to kind of try everything, and I think once you try them, then you start to, then it's the unnecessary things and the things you don't like about certain directions start to evaporate, and what stays is this you that you kind of, you know, it's called your style, I guess.
Yeah, no, totally, and I live on that, man. It's like don't judge it until you try it, kind of deal, right? So, it's one of those things where like I don't know what it's like to do, you know, animation. Let's try animation, you know, and really just give it a shot. And that's why I commend those guys that are so passionate and they've worked on different projects, because it just means they understand that much more. And I think that's what's great about, you know, us being an artist, is that, you know, we have the ability to, you know, keep growing. We don't stay in one place, and it doesn't get stagnant, you know. Mm-hmm. It's like if you want to stay in one place, that's great, you know. But if you feel like you're not growing, it's probably because you haven't given yourself a chance to experience other things. And to try other styles or to try other
popular.
Yeah, this whole project. I think it was for another like pitch, but it's like totally.
What the fuck?
It's like parents turn into like weird zombie
monsters.
They eat the kids. So this kid was basically comes home and serving his baby sister.
Oh god.
Time for dinner, and then I didn't think about it, but I was like, "Oh, dude, the composition, the knife is going straight into her butthole." Dude, that's like the worst.
Yes, even skipping the baby, like.
Yeah.
Oh, it goes further.
I watched Saw 3, by the way, yesterday, and it's quite similar.
Saw. So, oh, okay.
Yeah.
They chop up babies, or what?
Yeah.
Oh god!
They just open the head, so you know, with the brain and
let's see what else. This might be a fun one. This is something I learned at this is my last class at Art Center. It's called Architecture 2, and I learned kind of how to work and think this way through James Paik and. My teacher Farzad and Luke Maynard. And so Farzad, he was a concept artist, and also I believe he was one of the creative directors at what's that game company? It's a game company down in San Diego. I think it's called Moon Studios or Moonlight Studios. I might be getting it wrong, but he worked on a game called Dark Watch.
Okay.
And he basically taught us, you know, guys, before you get into doing environments, do these sketches, right? So this was my world, man. I love doing these little thumbnail sketches, mainly because I was scared to do a big sketch. I was this is my comfort zone, because you can hide so many mistakes, man. Look at this. Like, this little blotch, this is just like a little smudge, and it can mean so many things. So I did probably hundreds of these before getting comfortable to do a bigger image. And so this was like the thought process that they wanted us to think and design this way. And so, you know, the goal of the assignment was, you know, let's do a bunch of broad design ideas, a bunch of different viewpoints, a bunch of different concepts and compositions and lightings before we get into the nitty-gritty detail and the finalized painting. So I was doing this stuff, I got a lot of tips from James Paik about lighting and composition, and so he really helped me think about, you know, how do you not only do layout, but also how do you think about how this is going to convey your design, how this is going to convey the shot, the emotion, the narrative. And so you got to think about all these elements, and that's what's going to make your image very successful. It's not about just the flashy, cool brush strokes. And don't get me wrong, I'm a sucker for brush strokes and like the awesome custom brushes. But I really felt like the really good paintings had this kind of foundation. Really good designs had this kind of a sense of really good research and really good thinking behind.
Yeah,
and that's what makes, you know, images really clear. And there's a lot of clarity behind that, because, you know, without it, then there's no purpose, right?
Yeah. These kind of things has to be useful for the pipeline and for the later stages of.
Yeah, definitely. It's like, you know, like even doing this prop drawing of this statue, I was like, okay, great. This would be really good for modelers, because it's represented here, but it's like a blobby black thing that you don't quite understand. And you know, it's not until you draw it out that you get a better sense of the design. You get a better sense of, like, okay, it's a prop used in space. So that was such a great learning experience, and it makes you such a more conscious designer. And then you get into kind of the layout of, like, okay, what does the space look like? How large is it? How large is, like, the playground, or how large is the footprint of this space? And then you can get into the painting, right?
Yeah.
So I always felt like, you know, even in my, like, sometimes when I paint and draw, I always want to, like, I'm in such a hurry to, like, get, like, to rush into things, to skip steps. But I never realized, I was like, dude, this is such an important, you know, process to go through the steps to really figure out what it is that you want to design, what it is that you want to convey, and what it is that you want to illustrate. And so these steps were necessary for me, for myself, to build a stronger foundation.
So this is an Uncharted 3 project. So one of your concept projects you developed, right? To kind of, what was the purpose of that?
Yeah. So at school we had like these. Like this assignments of like, oh, you know, do an existing IP, okay, but do a sequel or a prequel. And so Uncharted 2 came out at the time, and I think this was 2010. Mm-hmm. And so, I guess I left Art Center in 2010. But basically, my friend and I, we basically teamed up and we decided to do Uncharted 3, and we called it World of Deceit. But I think it was just by coincidence that, you know, Naughty Dog was doing Uncharted 3, and I think we got in trouble for it too, because I got emails from like the studio or like producers. They're like, you can't be releasing this stuff. I was like, wait, I'm just a student, man. This was a misunderstanding. And they're like, oh shoot, you're just a student. Oh, okay. Because everyone thought this was like artwork.
It was good.
Yeah, I was like, dude, that's a compliment, dude. That's awesome. We're doing something right. And so we got really lucky that happened. And it just showed that, like, I was like, okay, cool. This is good. People like it. Studios respond to it. yeah, let's keep doing more. Let's keep doing more. So we ended. I ended up doing another project that's not Uncharted, but like Call of Duty. I think this was. It probably didn't get as much of that same attention, but this was like, you know, it was the same process. We did all these thumbnails, layout drawings, and then we did the final painting. So, yeah, it was cool, man. It was just a really cool experience to do, you know, to work and think this way, you know.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, because once you grab an existing IP, there is so much to start from, and you can give the designs that already exist your own twist and your own taste, and that's a really cool way to improve on your skills as well. And often you team up with other artists, right? So you tend to grab a lot of tricks, knowledge, and experience from them. So
yeah, exactly. And it's just like, it's so cool because I feel like everything that I'm doing today, it's not because I figured out on my own. It's because I was able to make friends. I was able to work with these other great artists, and it was because of them. It's like you are who you surround yourself. You know, mm-hmm. And it's like I felt like my artwork is the way it is because it's who I worked with or who I was exposed to. And it kind of defines the way I think. It defines the way I draw and defines the way I paint. And it's constantly evolving and constantly changing. And I feel like for me, it's a healthy experience because, you know, I feel less stagnant, right? I feel like I'm not always doing the same thing. And you know what? For those that love doing the same thing, dude, more power to them because they're just going to become the master of that.
Of this one thing, yeah.
Of that one thing. And they're going to be the best. And sooner or later, at one point, I'm going to ask them questions about how they did that because they know everything and anything about it. So it's a give and take. It's like, you know, you can be more broad or you can be more specific.
Mm-hmm.
This was just, you know, a layout drawing that I did. I think it was from the same semester. And our instructors wanted us to design environments like in three-quarter, and so this was like a layout drawing. When doing these drawings, honestly, are really boring. But the exciting part is having to figure out like the placement, having to figure out the design. So it's not until I got to do this drawing that I got to figure out the actual shot. So it went from this stage to this stage. And so at this stage, I knew exactly where my elements were. I knew exactly where what was going to be on this table, the general spacing, how many tables, and the general layout. And what's that?
So you would basically just focus on the lighting, on the actual mood of it, but you have all the things before, you know, thought through, and you were like, you know, you have then comfort that you can just, you know, go ahead and render style. And
yeah, because this is my cheat sheet, right? Like, this line drawing is basically my guideline, and this is something I can refer to. Because, man, when it comes to painting, I don't have the confidence to, like, do things on the fly. Like, meaning come up with ideas and paint awesome. I'm struggling trying to be awesome like those other guys, you know? Like when I look at the stuff that's on Facebook, and I look at, you know, Craig Mullins, Jamie Jones, John Liberto, you know, John Wallen Liberto. I mean, like, those guys are like, dude, what? How are you guys doing that? So they're like magicians to me, right? And for me, it's like, dude, I got to go at like 2 miles per hour. I can't. I'm struggling how to do lighting. I'm struggling how to do brush strokes.
I feel the same way. Like, I tend to separate one thing from another and try to nail it. Because when you have too many things, I tend to get overwhelmed and scared, and I'm kind of hesitant, and then procrastination starts, and it all gets messy. So extracting actual one step that seems manageable is much more easier.
Yeah,
exactly. It's like much more easier if you want to make some, you know, pretty picture. But if it has, like, you know, something which really attracts in the way of concept, in the, you know, the taste of the concept of the concept mind in the picture, is like, it attracts it attracts the viewer for a longer period, right? It's just gives you also the actual feeling that you made it good. You just didn't do only the beautiful picture, but you just make something that has the idea, that has storytelling, that has good concept and everything. So
exactly, dude. Because you know what? Like, if you're gonna do really pretty painting, you know, at least have not only like really great lighting and brushstrokes, but have some sort of narrative, right?
Mm-hmm.
There has to be something a little bit more in depth that's gonna give it that extra oomph, mm-hmm. right? That extra like that little bit of more juice. And so, you know, obviously I would probably paint this differently, but the design aspect, I felt like I achieved my goal was I wanted to create a space. And by the way, if I didn't mention it, but this space was basically supposed to be a sushi bar.
Mm-hmm.
And it basically, all the customers are Godzilla, right? So the ground is asleep. The chairs are burning buildings, right? And so when you walk into the space, everything's like interactive. Like the food that you eat, like the sashimi or like the sushi, they're like basically little humans.
I love these small planes and helicopters.
And then the helicopters and the airplanes are your lights. And so there's a lot of fun. You know, you're creating a lot of fun in this kind of space. And then you can illustrate it. And so it's like, it's a double whammy. It's like you have an awesome painting. And if you have an awesome idea, dude, it just makes it better.
Yeah. And exactly, that's why it has much more value, this picture.
Yeah. Much more value.
Because you just put much more effort into the thinking about the things.
It's
and
so unique
stuff.
At the same time.
And yeah.
Exactly.
You just put everything into that beautiful, you know, picture, but with its own, you know, concept behind it, and that's great.
You have no idea how relevant this Godzilla sushi restaurant is to one of our slang we have created during the level up session. So you will get to know.
Let's leave it on the end.
Awesome.
Let's see here. Let's go to. I guess I'll go to my mech series.
Yes,
please.
Man, you are so versatile. I just love to see how many different things you've done over the years. And sorry to say that, but all of them are extremely good. I love your animation stuff. I have never seen these from you. And I have never expected to see those. I don't know. I just, it happened that I have never came across them. And it's really, it has so much character. But at the same time, then you do Max and just like awesome. And I mean, so much thrive and need to pursue new paths in you that it really opens my mind to all sorts of things. Yeah,
thanks, man. I honestly, it's like, it's again, I don't mean to like toot anyone's horn, but it's really thanks to the people that I was around, because it's like I felt as an artist, like, or just as someone who was growing up, I felt really insecure about what I wanted to get into, because I don't know, you know, I don't know what's good for me, I don't know what path I want to take, and I have to just try it out. And it might not be, you know, appropriate for me to do animation. It might not be appropriate for me to do games or film, but I don't know until I try it, right? So whether I suck at it or whether I'm good at it, like, I will know once I get there. And so it brought me to this stage where I had this love and hate relationship with mechs, right? I love the fact that mechs are so well, like, engineered. There's so much design, but the hate aspect was, dude, there's so many mechs. There's so many mechs out there, man. You can't beat it. It's like there's so many good mech designs, and it's just like, oh man, how am I gonna be able to even get into this? Like, it's already all out there on the internet. It's already all out there. Like, the Japanese, you know, guys have been doing it for years. You know, with like, you know, Appleseed, Gundam, all that stuff, dude. Like, they've kind of conquered it, and then now you got like a lot of like different designers, like American designers, doing their thing. So I wanted to try it out, and my background doing mechs was a little bit more, I guess you can kind of still see the whimsical aspect, like it's still like kind of cartoony, But I loved looking at, you know, joints. You know, I think that was my main focus for a long time, was looking at just like how things can move, or the mechanical aspects. I think aesthetically, a lot of these, if you guys look at it closely, they're really blocky. I mean, they look like Legos, right? They're just like big boxes, but I loved things that had like articulation. I loved, you know, gears that move in an interesting way, mainly because, you know, I felt like I haven't really seen that in mechs as much, right? And I felt like that was my area where I wanted to explore. I was really curious about that, and so a lot of these designs here were inspired off of power tools. You know, I was looking at my I had like a little drill, you know, power drill, and I was looking at like the buttons, and I was looking at the inner like mechanics. I was like, oh, dude, it'd be awesome if like the pivot point of a mech had that kind of aesthetic, you know, in terms of like how it can move. It'd be cool if the feet were more, I don't know, maybe they weren't like actual feet, maybe they were like weird clamps that can take a certain amount of pressure. It'd be interesting if, you know, some of the joints, the way they move here, it might move like, I don't know, not like a traditional head, but more like up and down, right? So I was looking at like different things for inspiration, like my lamp. I have like this really shitty desk lamp, and this entire series was kind of based off my desk lamp, right? If you look at this here closely, this joint, this was inspired by kind of like how your lamp moves, right? So all the answers, all the design answers are kind of around you. They're like right in your face, but it's how you look at it, and it's how you interpret it will kind of define you as a designer, you as a problem solver, you and your in your final illustration.
That's so true. Once I remember the point when I was watching Noman videos from Scott, basic one about perspective and such, and I was drawing stuff around me like a printer and really mechanical stuff that was around me. And once I like started looking at this and kind of deconstructed, I was figuring out, hey, this printer looks like a spaceship station or something.
Oh, yeah.
I would just like add small thing or change it here and there, and you know, it was really just a huge boom in my head. Like, okay, these things around me are actually kind of science fiction, if I want.
Yeah, exactly. They're actually kind of cool. Watch, I hope everyone, after the segment, everyone goes, starts taking photos of their printer, and then you'll have printer space stations. That'd be awesome. let's see, this was, this was really cool. So, you know, I'm going to keep mentioning Ben Morrow, because, you know, He's kind of like him and I. We have a long history of being classmates and being roommates, and you know, just kind of working and living together. But this was a cool sketch session that we had, and we were like, dude, what if like you designed a vehicle that had one wheel? And to be honest, it's not a new concept. It's not. It's actually been it's a concept that's been done many times, but we wanted to give ourselves boundaries, right? And the whole boundary aspect was like, okay, it has to be one wheel, and it has to be made out of junk. It has to be made out of, like, car parts or something. So everything that's in here is just car parts, right? So we started off, like, just doing, you know, loose sketches, figuring out the silhouette or proportion. And then when we get into the final details, I was looking at, like, car engines. I was looking at, like, junkyards and stuff like that to kind of convey, you know, the further details, to convey some of the subtle nuances or like, you know, the nitty-gritty aspects of the design. And I didn't know it, but I was like, oh dude, it's all about going from simple to complex, right? Broad to specific. And that even works in every term. It works for design, it works for painting, it works for storytelling, you know, it works for like everything. Like Even when we look at like trailers for movies, like trailers is basically like an appetizer, right? It's something simple. It's something like, it's like a little broad or very vague snippet of eventually what you're going to watch, which is a full-on two-hour movie, right? And I feel like the thumbnail process and, like, ideating or, you know, generating all these little sketches is basically your appetizer to your main course. So, I was...
Yeah, that's such a cool metaphor for that.
Really yeah, I'm like filled with really shitty analogies, so excuse me. Like I'm gonna be throwing more of those really crappy.
No, actually, it's pretty relevant.
Oh man, just go ahead. It's awesome.
But I was always like, you know, I liked doing smaller sketches, mainly because you know it's like I wasn't really convinced about getting into the nitty gritty details yet. I wanted to explore before, you know, settling on like okay. This is going to be what I want to eat, or this is going to be what I want to settle on, or this is going to be what I want to watch as a movie. And so as a drawing or a design, it's like, okay, this is what I'm going to be designing. And as long as I'm really happy with the thumbnail or I'm really happy with the small sketch, I know that I'm going to generally be happy with the final execution, because if it looks good small, it's going to look good big, right?
Yeah.
And so... I really tried to kind of, you know, have that in mind when I was doing these mech series.
Yeah, because you didn't mess up with the shapes, with the, you know, actual look of the thing, which you are looking at from the distance, right? You just have the silhouettes established and everything, and then you can just focus on the details, that actual, you know, the polishing parts, that because you have... All of the functionality already outlined, and you can just go, you know, deeper. So
yeah, exactly. Here's another set here. Mm. So it's like this is very like it's very textbooky, you know. And I'm not saying like, oh hey guys, you know, this is the way to work. Do silhouette sketch and then painting. Mm-hmm. I'm just saying that, you know, it worked for me, and this is a really good, you know, way of thinking if you don't know where you're going with your design or if you don't know where you're going with your sketch. So mm-hmm. anytime you have a roadblock, and I have so many roadblocks, right? It's really good to like, okay, let's just stop painting. I need to go back and let me just like think about it, and let me think about it in the most simplest way, right? And so for mech design, there's so many complicated areas. Like, okay, what's the most simplest way? It's like, all right, cool, it's a silhouette, right? It's either a silhouette or a sketch. You can go either or. And that's why I'm so amazed when I see other illustrators or other designers do the thinking and the painting at the same time. Those guys are magicians, man. They're just like, they're doing all the drawing, all the designing, all the thinking up in their head. And it's just like magic, you know? But like my brain, because again, I'm not super smart or anything. I just want to kind of go through the notions and kind of the motions of like, okay, what does it take to make a design? I'm so like step by step. Like that's the only way I can work and think. Is like everything has to kind of go through a series of like small steps, you know?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but it all put together works very well, because we just see that your designs and the things that you depict are well through, you know, you are thinking before you are doing actually. It's like you say that it's like some of the guys can do it both of the ways, but I think that you are too humble at this point, and this is amazing that the actual concepts are thought before you actually did it, because you know it's more structured, more well designed, and yeah.
These rabbits on the Mac, what they were doing.
What's that?
Can you go back?
Uh-huh. Oh, do you see these rabbits right here?
Oh, yeah. I can see them.
Yeah. I think when I posted this, one of my friends was like, he was like, cool design, but dude, this is my favorite part right here, man. This is
a selling point.
This is your design right here, these rabbits.
This is the key mark of the picture.
Yeah. And you know what, man? Honestly, it's at the end of the day, it's art. You just have fun, like whatever it is. And this is like really perverted. I would probably not do this again because people are gonna be, like, you know, when you have art directors or when you get into the professional world, they're gonna look at this stuff. They're gonna look at this and they're gonna look at you and think, man, this John Park guy, he's like super perverted. Like, putting humping bunnies on mechs, like, dude, we can't have that here at our studio. This is not good. So, but you know what? Have fun. I think you gotta have. You think you gotta really have fun with your designs. You gotta really have fun with your image making. You gotta really have fun with your paintings, your illustrations. I think if you have fun, it shows through. So.
Of course. Yeah, that is the answer you have to towards the stuff you do. Yeah.
Thank you. I mean, like, so, you know, I always start with a drawing and then I always go with painting. And you know what? This is just the way my brain works. And I know guys, I know guys like, you know, Kang Lee, Jamie Jones, Craig Mullins, those guys, like, and James Paik, they can do all this stuff at the same time. And honestly, when I was starting out, I thought that was the way to paint and draw, but it's not. They actually did the drawings. They actually did the planning. They actually did the designing. Yeah. They just don't have time to go through the process, so they're just doing it all at once. And you know, for me, I'm still learning. And when I was a student, I was like, okay, I gotta still go through those motions. I gotta still do the research. I gotta still do the drawings before I get ahead of myself to do the big epic painting. So, yeah, this is like, you know, just some of the sketches for this mech series and some of my thought process for all this stuff.
That looks great. Yeah, thank you for sharing the process behind all of these. And that looks like a pretty bumpy journey, like tons of different stuff you did. And the volume is crazy as well. I feel so bad right now. I feel like drawing, god damn it.
You know, dude, do both, man. Like, I sometimes I'm like, when I paint too much, I want to draw more, right?
Yeah.
And when I draw, I'm like, dude, I got to get into painting. And so it's fun, man. It's really fun to kind of have a balancing act.
You're brushing out.
Yeah, exactly. And you know, 3D's such a big thing now. It's like 3D, and it's something that I'm not really good at, and I'm learning from my really good friend Fausto DeMartini, and you know, he's kind of training me, and he's basically like my tutor, you know. So far I only know how to do like boxes and stuff, but dude, I see some of the stuff that the other guys are doing, like Fausto DeMartini, Vitaly Bogorov, Gabriel, Ben Morrow, all these guys, man, they're just doing such phenomenal work in 3D. And you know what? Why not pick up 3D? Why not try it out? It's not gonna hurt me, you know. It's just another tool that I can put onto my little tool set, right?
Of course.
This was a mech design that I did for Spider-Man. And I believe a lot of it was kind of initially designed by Ben Morrow, Robert Simmons, and Aaron Beck. So those guys, I know they kind of did the initial you know, hard work and doing all the explorations. I came in later in the project for about like a week or so, and I just did a small portion, and this was kind of my take on that Rhino character. And it's kind of sad because when I watched Spider-Man, this Rhino character was only in the film for like, what, 5-10 minutes or something? I was like, oh, dude, that kind of sucked. It sucked because it seemed like they worked on this design for months, you know?
Uh-huh.
And like, you have so much anticipation, and when you watch the film, you're like, oh, dude, they only showed this for like 5 minutes on the screen. You know, they probably have the reasons why they did that, but it was a very, like, it was fun at first, and then you're like, oh man, it wasn't sad. You wanted more, you know, you weren't satisfied.
Yeah, that's your little baby, right? You just been working on it for like months. You want to see it.
It's like, man, but yeah, definitely check out some of those other guys' work. You know, obviously Ben Morrow, obviously, you know, Robert Simmons and Aaron Beck. Those guys are phenomenal mechanical designers, and they're just their sensibility in design and mechanics is like it's none other. It's just like they're crazy at what they do. So, yeah. So that's my mech series. Here's a little general process. So, you know, I don't. Hopefully, I can try to do a little bit of painting today. But generally, like, I'll do like a sketch, right, in my sketchbook, and then I'll scan it in. And then this will be like my general color palette. And the color palette can come from, like, you know, whether it's like intuitive or whether it's like from a photograph or something. Or, you know, you can color pick from Photoshop. And then just laying the base down and then basically kind of blocking out your values, right? So I blocked out my values a little bit. It's still relatively sketchy if you look at it. I mean, it kind of still is sketchy at the end, but this is kind of the way I went about painting. Was it was very formulaic. It was very like, burp, 1, 2, 3. You know, mm-hmm. It's kind of like line drawing, under painting, and then painting on top. So, again, like I still don't have the confidence, and I'm still practicing. But like, how to do things simultaneously, dude? That's like a magic trick, man. I don't know how some of the guys, like Jay Jones, he's probably one of the best painters that I know. As far as like illustration goes, and yeah. Design and mood, lighting, narrative, dude, the guy can do just things that are just out of this world. And so when I see him doing stuff, I'm just like, what did you start with? Wait, what? How did you get that lighting? How'd you get those textures? And a part of me, like a big part of me actually, is, dude, hey bro, give me that secret brush, man. I know you have that brush that will answer all my problems.
Where's my awesome button?
Yeah, where's my awesome button? Like, I need an awesome button. I know you have an awesome button in there. So.
Yeah, like, that's what we want to see from you today as well.
I want to see an awesome button from you guys. What's that awesome button,
your
guys?
Session, man. This is your session. No, we didn't have any. We just suck.
I don't have an awesome button.
Yeah, you have just awesome hands, I guess. Awesome brain.
For those of you guys that, like, you know, if you guys seen my my assassin painting or my pew pew cowboys, generally I like to start with like a little sketch, mm-hmm. and then I kind of go through the motions of like, you know, doing a background, just to get my general mood. I mean, there's no real mood in here, but it's just a big dark triangle. And then I work with my sketch. I mean, my sketch is always, it's a footprint, right? It's not something that I always have on top of my painting, but I use it as guidelines. And so if you look here, it's not all painted. This is actually photo dropped, right? Mm-hmm. It's just my way of kind of like it being a little bit, you know, cluster, you know, it's very hacked together. But I wanted to try off, you know, start off with the photo. And there's other guys that work phenomenally this way. Do you guys know Steve Messing?
Yeah.
Dylan Cole. Those guys are like the master
of using in the
of matte painting. Like, they're such good designers. Yeah. They're like, dude, the stuff that they do with the photographs that they take, the way they paint, the way they light is like insane. Those guys are insane. Another guy, Maciej Kuchura.
Our Polish fellow. Yeah, we got him once. Dude,
I always bastardize his name, but Maciej Kuchura, like he's such a badass too. He uses everything. I think he uses like 3D painting, you know, photos, anything, whatever goes, man. That guy's like pretty versatile, and you know. You know, Jamie Jones, he has such a painterly quality, and I, you know, when I was doing these series, I really wanted to understand, you know, his world. I wanted to understand what he thinks about when he's painting, and he's someone I wanted to thank because he kind of got me into the world of, like, oh, let's look at traditional artists. You know, when I look at his work, I'm like, man, something about it feels very, you know, very classical. It feels very like, you know, American artists or old Renaissance artists, you know what I mean? Like, it feels like like Sargent or, you know, Zorn or something like that. And
there's plenty of those inspirations everywhere. If you will dive deeply into inspirations of those artists, you will be amazed how much they borrow from the past artists they love. And that's the quality you admire, because they have such a big taste for these things that they just extracted.
Yeah, it's a matter of research that you are doing from your own.
Not necessarily research. I wouldn't call it that way. Maybe it's just your personal taste. Yes, but it takes time to look at these things.
Find something that inspire you, and then you can just, you know, grab from the artist, from the past. It's something that really is similar to your soul.
And the grabbing process isn't that easy.
Yeah, exactly.
You have to deconstruct and understand.
Yeah.
And then you can use it as your tool.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay, so we have a mech here.
And it kind of brings me to my next segment. I learned this process from Kang Lee, and he's also another artist and designer I've admired for years, because of this book Skillful Huntsman. And he works in this ingenious way where I learned how to do, like, you know, have a silhouette, right? It's kind of like these ink blotches, and then you actually apply a photo to the silhouette, and you apply it in a very abstract way to get loose textures and to get color, right? So for me, I was like, oh, dude, I don't have to have a line drawing? That's awesome. And so this was kind of like, you know, the where you get to do a lot of, like, you know, hide and seek. There's a lot of revealing involved, where you kind of get to unveil some of the details as you're laying photos, as you're laying, you know, textures, as you're painting on top. You're kind of getting a sense of, like, okay, what is my design? What is my image? Because your silhouette is locked, right? So, design-wise, I got my impression, but now I'm, like, working inside out.
Mm-hmm. So what about this tiny details that you have in... Because someone is in the chat just asking, what about the tiny details that you are putting onto the mech design? It's like you are thinking about the functionality of every tiny details, or you are just thinking about the functionality overall as the whole, you know, mech, and then just go deeper into the details with the functionality.
Hopefully I can answer that in this. It's like, if you guys think about mech design, think about what makes mechs cool. Initially, it's kind of like the silhouette. It's whether they have big guns or big, like, arms and legs. But the next thing, if you think about it, it's really the anatomy of it, right? It's the mechanics that make it feel like it's been engineered, or that make it feel like it's a believable robotic thing. Yeah. And I always kind of refer to, like, the human body, right? What makes a human body is actually kind of the anatomy, the pose, but also kind of like our structure, right? So mm-hmm. I always look at the kneecaps, the hips, the arms, anything that resembles a joint.
Yeah.
So those joints, when I do my mech renders, they tend to be always dark, because it's a reminder that I need to put some sort of mechanical detail in these zones, right? Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Anything that's outside of these zones are basically they're more like car covers, right? It's kind of like the outside of a car. It's a shell, or it's like a panel, and you're basically kind of showing mechanical areas, and in the contrasts, you're showing just the covers. So that's kind of the way I think about mech design, and I know some of the more successful mech designers, they basically design around that. They think that way. They construct that way, and they actually that's what makes their designs look very believable, you know.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And mechanical design or mech designs, it's all about mechanical believability.
Yeah.
So it's like, if you can just hint at, like, oh, there's a little suspension here. Oh, there's suspension here, and there's a little bit of a mechanical cog or wheel or some sort of, like, hinge here, then your brain starts to kind of fill in the rest, right? And so that's what makes it somewhat of, like, a comprehensive or, you know, a believable design.
Yeah, actually, that's something that's moving, that has much more focus on the details, right? About the functionality, the parts that are moving around, that really have the logic in terms of the detail, the design.
Yeah, exactly. And you know, when once you have your details, it's like, okay, let's show it off. Because, you know, when you have a mech design, it's really cool to have all the details, but when you want to show a cool illustration, you want to convey it in through mood, right? Yeah. And so, and like I said, like some of those other guys I mentioned, they're so fantastic at mood, and it's all about not showing everything, but kind of showing snippets. So here's an example of, like, you know, background, and then indicating some sort of, like, space that this thing would be in, and then you light it, or a little bit more detail, and you start to darken, and then as you're darkening the background, you start to kind of hide or consolidate some of the details on the mech. You guys see how, like, now I'm like creating little pockets of light,
yeah,
just showing like, okay, here's some mechanical detail, and then here's a shadow. Here's some more mechanical detail here, and here's a shadow. So, that was kind of the step-by-step process for this particular image. Going from here.
How much time does it take you to create that kind of illustration concept? Let's say it's like an illustration with concept behind it, right?
Oh man, dude, if it's like professional, I feel that the design aspect tends to go, you know, sometimes a day, maybe a couple days, sometimes even a week, you know, just because, like, there's so many problems and so many things that you got to figure out, right? You got to figure out the details, you got to figure out the architecture, you got to figure out the functionality, you got to figure out, like, the aesthetic and all these things before you can illustrate.
Mm-hmm.
And so I find that, like, the research and the design aspect take a long time because you gotta plan all those things out before going and illustrating.
Actually, it's sometimes more than actual painting. So.
Yeah, you know, and you know, I think there's kind of a misconception, like, you know, I've gotten into a little bit of trouble when I was, like, you know, doing speed paintings, because it's not, you know, for our art community, it's fine. You know, like, you're like, oh dude, I did a speed painting and, like, you know, 20, 30 minutes, and it's really cool, inspiring, but only artists can understand that, right? Producers, you know, directors, you know, your supervisors who aren't artists, they will never understand that. So what happens is that you're creating a bad precedent, you know, you're kind of saying, like, oh, I can do any job or any task you give me in 30 minutes, and you don't want to be in that position, because then you essentially shot yourself in the foot, right?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
And so I think for within the artist community, dude, 5 minutes speed painting, I'm all down. I'm all for that. But you know what? Let's keep that to ourselves, because, man, that can backfire so hard, because when you're on a job,
yeah.
I've had you know, jobs or freelance opportunities where, you know, the client will be like, oh, hey, John, I noticed you did this painting in 30 minutes. Well, if your hourly rate is $50, can I give you $25 for an illustration? I was like, what? Dude, you're crazy.
I had the same kind of experience. It's like you can't just express anything that you are doing. So.
Yeah, it's crazy. But, you know, I can't blame them at the same time. I can't blame them because that's the way I promoted it, you know? Holy shit, sorry. This is a big jump. I think I might skip some steps, but... That was on me. It's the way I promoted it, and it's the way I essentially said, hey, this is how fast I can work. I can solve all your problems in 30 minutes, dude.
Yes.
It's not always the case, you know? It's not always the case. So, if you guys are watching this, this is just kind of like a step-by-step. It's like I always start off really blotchy. It's like abstract, and then you're kind of like slowly defining, you know, what it is that you want to get to, which is, you know, the structure, the layout, the details, and then everything in the details come alive as soon as you light it. So this is kind of the end result.
Nice. It has that kind of that Craig Mullins feeling in it, I can feel.
Oh, like, man, Craig Mullins is, dude, he's my morning coffee. I always have to look at his work before anything else. Before I have to get up and take a piss or anything, like, I have to look at his work for 5-10 minutes And they're like, okay, I'm ready. Like, dude, he's a reason why I want to continue to pursue painting. He's the reason why I always feel like I'm chasing that the rabbit, right? Down mm-hmm. the hole. It's like I know I'll never catch it, but it gives me a reason to live. It gives me a reason or a purpose to, you know, push harder, because, you know, Craig Mullins is, I'm sure he's trying to chase his own rabbit, but it's like, for me, it's like, I'm like, how did he do that? How did he put those textures? Oh man, I need to try that in my next painting. And so it's always fun. It gives you a reason to keep pushing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Let's see here.
That's right. God damn it.
Here's another mech. Mm-hmm. Mech right here.
So you started this one in traditional media as well?
So yeah, I started this one in traditional. This is a, you know, ballpoint ink pen. And then I basically kind of laid my black and white. So I worked in this one, I worked a little differently. I just did black and white values. And then I got into color, because I wasn't confident, or I didn't feel I needed to figure out the lighting scenario before I figured out the color. And there's no right or wrong way, you know. Like, I feel like art and the process is so subjective. But for me, I needed to figure out the lighting and then figure out the color, because the color is kind of like, okay, I can borrow elements from a helicopter, or I can borrow elements from a tank, and then I can apply the textures. And then from there, it's kind of like, then I can focus on the details more. So you can see here where I'm still using my line drawing as kind of an overlay on top, and then I'm slowly kind of working. I'm working those details out, right? So I don't want my line drawings to dictate everything. I just want them to be a guideline, right? Because sometimes in the painting, there's things that you can't do in the line drawing, but you can do in the painting, right?
Mm-hmm.
So, and you guys see these parts right here. Like, I started creating a kitbash PSD file of just parts. And these parts are like little elements. They're like little, like, flavors. They're like little spices that I would put, you know, into my scrambled egg that make it delicious. But but they're like little snippets, right? That give me ideas and you know, reasons for designing certain areas with more detail. Mm-hmm. And so
yeah, it makes it more efficient. I saw Ben in one of his tutorial videos on YouTube doing the same. Like, he had like one mother file, like, mm-hmm. pretty huge file with tons of references that he started grabbing from.
Yeah, and it's such a great way of working. You know, it's not the way to work. You know, it's one way of working. Just like with painting, there's not the way to work. You know, there's one way of working. There's another way of working. There's so many different approaches and methods that make art, that make illustration, like, really fun. You know, mm-hmm. and so, you know, for me, like, I feel like, dude, why not try it out? Try everything out, because you might like some methods better than others, and your art actually might have a different effect if you work with all photos, you know?
And actually, you'll never know if you don't try, right?
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, so exactly. That's why you need that hunger you were talking about, to kind of pursue different paths and be brave enough to take the challenges,
yeah, exactly. You know, and you know, it's like, if you feel like you mess up in the process, dude, who cares? You know, I mean, there's no shame. I mean, you know, if you don't feel confident about it, just don't show it. Let it be your own personal thing. But as an artist, I feel like that's the very thing that's going to stimulate you to get you to the next step, right?
Mm-hmm.
So,
that looks great.
Let's see here. I think that's about it for what I wanted to show you guys with my old work. I mean, there's stuff on my blog that I can post, that I can bring up.
We just posted the link to your blog on the event page, so people can just go there and see the
We are stuff. Getting pretty close to the 2 hours, but I think we will just extend it for the sake of the demo.
Yeah,
okay. I think we all want to see it as well. It was great. The process you showed us, like, about Max and all these things. Looks great. So thank you for that.
Yeah, thank you guys.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, if you are, you know, up for it, John, you can just paint for something for us.
Yeah, for sure, guys. I can't promise that it'll be anything like awesome, but I will show you kind of my general process of how I think about some of these things. So this is something that I've been trying to do. This is all of Zorn. I think there might be some artists in here that I might have mixed in, so I apologize for that. But I've been really interested in some of these classical artists because it's not only the application, but it's also the way they convey an image, right? And mm-hmm. Dude, these guys, they didn't have 3D, they didn't have Photoshop, they didn't have, you know, they weren't able to move things in space. What they had was a 2D image, right? Which makes them probably one of the best graphic designers of their time. And that's why these images look so successful, because of the way they kind of distribute shapes, the way they kind of arranged everything, and just both on a compositional and lighting level. So for those of you who are more keen on illustration, I think this might kind of register.
I love Zorn.
Or, you know, connect with those people. Let's say I took an image from this, say, just to kind of kick things off. What if I got this, right? And this is obviously an awesome Zorn painting.
Yeah.
And what I'm going to do is I'm going to expand it. Oh, this is like almost perfect. Perfect crop. Okay. I'm not going to paint on top of it, but what I want to do is I want to analyze the masses. So looking at this, just in terms of the actual composition, you know, I have this huge triangular thing, right? This big kind of mid to foreground element. And then I have these elements back here that kind of stagger. And notice the way I'm actually kind of like simplifying it, right? I don't want to get too specific and say, oh yeah, it's an arm and, you know, here's the face. It's like, no, this is just a big volume. And then back here is a big line, right?
Mm-hmm.
And just to be even more clear, let's color code this so that it's represented in a way that we can understand through just color. Sorry if, you know, this is going to be pretty elementary looking. I'm going to be like, all right, guys, bring out your crayons. Let's color. Color, you know, fill in the blanks. But it was such a refreshing exercise for me to kind of understand the graphic breakup of how these artists, you know, painted and how they just thought about things. Let's see here. By the way, guys, all the brushes that I'm using, I can't take credit. They're all brushes that have completely, you know, took from, you know, DeviantArt. You know, huge props go to Jama.
You know, yeah, it's
awesome brushes. Another artist named Shadi Safadi, he has awesome brushes too, and definitely Jamie Jones. They've done the hard work for me. You know, I'm just kind of piggybacking off of what they created. So there's all these like awesome brushes here. That's just like, look at that, man. That looks gorgeous. So when I have something like this, it's such a nice graphic breakup, because we have these, you know, large, medium. They're all kind of medium, but if I break it up more, there's probably, you know, small, right? So there's all these different proportions, and it's the proportions that kind of make the image look interesting.
Yeah.
So when I do my character when I do like my illustrations or my compositions, I actually try to adopt what they establish in their paintings, and try to see something different. Like, maybe this is like, you know, as I'm painting or drawing, I usually like to start off with a drawing, but maybe this is an interesting scene for,
you know. So you like, basically extract the abstraction from a master painting, and it's not even a composition, it's like the layout of masses in a really abstract way, right?
Yeah, it's like the layout that they do. It's so amazing. And then just even that, I would have never have thought of that unless I had like a preconceived idea of like you know, how they, of like an image that I was thinking about. But just even something like this, I don't know what he's holding, but for the sake, his arm is doing this. He's holding a gun that's going out this way. Then there's something in here, like some ground. And then maybe this is like clouds or something, and this is like the sky. And maybe he's looking up. He's looking up at like some dudes up here that are looking down at him. And so as a composition, that's already interesting for me, rather than doing, you know, something that's conventional or like, you know, kind of cliche. Right? There's a lot of different, just the way that it's compositionally broken up, there's a lot of different arrangement that I can start with as a base. Paint on. Obviously, like, a lot of this stuff needs figuring out, but even, like, again, just taking this image and even rotating it sideways. I promise. I'll start painting soon.
Don't worry. I think it's it's really more interesting than
yeah, the way
you think it is. You know, it's just that it's the yeah. What happens in your brain. What makes your painting so unique and strong? You know, it's exactly this, I guess. This inspiration and where you get it from.
Thanks.
Yeah.
Yeah. Like I don't know. Like, you know, doing demos is always scary because it's like it's always like a performing arts, right? It's like, man, if I do a shitty demo, then people are gonna be like, dude, this is like the worst. This is like the worst lecture or talk I've been to, and it's scary, man. But
don't worry, it's all casual. We're all casual here, so there's no way you can fail on that, really. Yeah. So.
Awesome. I'll be sure to do a shittier painting just for them.
Oh god, I think it was like it's already enough of knowledge, I guess. I mean, just so awesome to see the. Yeah, I have never thought about it, even though I knew that there's some kind of, you know, abstraction behind all of those, but I have never gone so deeply into that and inspired my paintings off of them. But yeah, it's a great way to create compositions outside of your own box, because, you know, you probably had this, you tend to stick to certain shape design and
right.
masses you use all the time. So this is a great way to go outside and learn from the past, basically.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. I mean, and here's the thing about, like, process. There's no right or wrong way. It's whatever's going to get you there. And it's gonna whatever's gonna get you there in a timely manner, whatever's gonna get you there to help you solve your problems. Like, dude, let that be your process, man.
Mm-hmm.
Whether you need to, like, you know,
ladders
or something. Yeah, let that be your process.
It all comes to the result, right? Just to be honest. And
yeah,
if you have fun with, you know, trying different things and you know, even when you fail during the process, it doesn't matter really, because you just want to achieve the actual, you know, your picture. And when it comes to the success, it doesn't really matter how the way looked before when you started
yeah.
out or just messing around. It just doesn't matter.
Exactly.
And actually, we can see that you have very, you know, beautiful line work. So, and you have the composition, and you can just go ahead with it. And yeah.
I mean. Like, dude, this composition, not to toot my own horn, but, like, I would have never came up with this. Again, I can't take credit. Like, this was all based on what Zorn did, right?
Yeah, but you showed much different way of approaching to the picture actually. So
it's
your own way. It's your own way. So
yeah, it's like, you know what? Like, here's the thing. Like, I don't mind people cheating, but if you're gonna cheat, just be clever about it, right? Mm-hmm. It's like if you're gonna cheat, don't like cheat and do like another. Be like 150% cheater. Like, you know, take it to the next level. To the point where people are like, "Dude, that's not cheating. That's you're like reinventing." It's like, no, I mean, I'm obviously borrowing a lot. It's just I'm just, you know, utilizing or thinking about it very differently. And so in this case, it's like obviously it's just my cowboy dude, but it's like it uses the same volumes, it uses the same proportions, the same graphic layout, the breakups, and it's like, dude, why not? You know, it's a different way of thinking. It's a different way of starting an image.
Yeah.
Even doing this, like, man, it'd be awesome. Like, what if I did my assassin dude? You know what? Honestly, guys, like the reason why I've been doing these assassin characters, and the reason why I have cowboys and hats and assassins with hoodies,
uh-huh.
is faces are so hard to paint. It's like my excuse of saying, like, yeah, I can do a character design, but I'll have him in shadow. You know,
it'll look cool.
Yeah, it'll look pretty cool, right? Just have him in shadow, like, whatever, man. It's all good. You know, I don't even want to try. I'm just like other guys. I'll let them be the best at characters. Like, I don't even. No, it's gonna be in shadow. I don't know why I'm spending time on that. But you can already see, like, there's something here, like, you know, whether it's a design or whether it's a pose, like, there's something that I'm extracting just on a graphic design level, and maybe even on a lighting level, you can start to pull interesting elements. Mm-hmm. Maybe all this can be in shadow. but yeah, like, you know, a lot of the way I work, when it comes to painting, like, you know, sometimes I will just start pushing paint, but when I need to figure out a composition, I'll actually start it off with an actual drawing, you know, and I'll start layering, start my footprint with, you know, this line drawing before I start pushing or putting color down.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so it still comes down, and it's still pretty visible that you like to figure things out before you actually commit, right? So it's like the stuff you showed us from Art Center. First you analyze and kind of came up with a process, and then you dive into it, then you make yourself comfortable having like an idea and choice maybe, and then mm-hmm. you come up to it, yeah. And that's pretty efficient, I guess. It makes you choose from, you know, different types of things, so you can pick the best one.
Yeah, and so, like, exactly, like, you know, have a bunch of different sets that I can choose from, and, you know, obviously, like, when I look at this, I'm like, you know, maybe it wasn't as good as I initially thought, so I might move things around, or I might change the composition, or I might just even, you know, just do an extension, or, you know, or even like maybe just go with this one, and it's all just like you want to create options for yourself, because you're going to be spending the next couple hours really painting and illustrating this, you know, to your liking.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know what's cool too is this is just me being lazy, and I honestly have no theory for color. I look at what other artists do, and I'll actually just bring this down. I'll desaturate it. I'll actually do a color balance, things of that nature, to kind of get an interesting color palette to kind of work off of. And then I'll start using this as a footprint to start, like, just, you know, color booking, right?
Mm-hmm.
So this is me just laying down, you know, just the different colors, maybe indicating, you know, really loose textures or whatnot. you know, not really, I'm not like doing any value or lighting just yet. I just want to get kind of the graphic design of, you know, of this general image, right? And making sure that it reads. And you'll kind of notice, like, it looks, when people are looking at this, they're like, dude, why is he being all weird and, you know, schizophrenic with the colors? It's because I actually don't want to settle and say, like, hey, he's wearing a brown jacket. But, you know, maybe I can slightly, I can just kind of lightly do underpainting, or that give the illusion of underpainting, and just kind of overlay multiple colors on there, and it gives it kind of that nice complexity that we like in these traditional pieces.
It's really great to see how these paintings that you've been showing off, you know, last couple months on Facebook are coming up here. So I'm really thankful you're joining us today and showing it all and sharing without, you know, skipping any parts. Yeah, so that's just gold. I mean, people will surely appreciate it, and I guess that's what's happening right now. So guys, if you enjoy what John is sharing with us today, just go follow him on Facebook if you are not already. Yeah, I'm really impressed by the amount of generosity we are getting from our guests.
Oh yeah, absolutely, guys. I mean, again, if it's not me, it's going to be someone else. And you guys have been sharing a lot, and the other artists in the community have been really like just sharing the process. And it's, you know what, it just makes our generation of artists that much stronger. Mm-hmm. And you know, why be alone in it? You know, like, just, you know, not to sound like a total hippie, but it's like, dude, we thrive so much better together than alone.
Yeah.
So it's like, I'd rather really be a part of the group. I'd rather, you know, just learn things together, you know.
So coming back to the process, you now you're doing it like color blocking, basically, using modified Zorn palette, right? Now you're introducing your own colors.
Right.
Okay.
So yeah, I'm introducing just like some of these elements. Obviously, this was from a Zorn, like modified Zorn palette, and I switched the hue a little bit.
Yeah.
And I kind of wanted the stacking nature, and then maybe it's like, oh, here's a little bit of sky or whatnot. And this is just kind of get a sense of, like, you know, the graphic design of the entire image before committing and doing a full-blown painting, and just making sure, like, okay, maybe I can have a little bit more cools here, maybe some of the, a little bit more color and variation in the clouds, because, you know, when I turn off my, oh, shoot, I started painting on a line drawing. That's awesome. Whatever. It's all good. All right, this is what I'll do. I'll save it. I'll save out this chunk. Okay. Maybe I can save out this chunk too. Okay. So that way I kind of have this nice base to start off of. And then, you know, this line drawing is just kind of a guideline for me. Should probably lock this up. That's kind of the way I've been approaching these paintings, is surely through, you know, starting off with the line drawing and kind of building it up as it goes. And, you know, I don't have a strong, like, traditional painting background. Like, I rarely do, you know, real painting as is. But I try to study and analyze, like, okay, if this was a real painting, or, you know, how would like these masters do it? How would Zorn paint it? Or how would like these other artists that I admire, how would they have gone and kind of figured out the lighting and all this stuff?
Uh-huh.
So, like, even all of these, all the creases and stuff here, like, they give me good information for mark making. And they give me really good, valid information for, you know, okay, maybe it's darker here, or, you know, it's like I have a fold here. So just to kind of help reinforce my anatomy. reinforce, you know, just some of the decisions or why I'm putting this color here or why I'm putting that mark there. It all comes from the drawing.
Yeah, that's how important it is, right? So slowly introduce like a second value that is basically like a shadow pattern, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. All right.
Then maybe from here, I'll do something like this. Just, I don't know, use Photoshop to the fullest extent. Make it dark.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah, that's like a layer mask, and now we paint it.
Yeah, layer mask. And then maybe what if this was just all in shadow, dude? You know? That might be interesting.
Yeah, and it shows like you started from one place, right? And now you're changing that shape structure completely, but I mean, that's the process, right? So
yeah.
It makes it all fun, I guess, to start somewhere and then come up with things as you go, and you know, make it still fun. You don't have to follow certain route
even. Yeah, exactly. Yeah, you make it so that you don't feel pressure to work that one way just because someone told you so. It's like, dude, work that way because, you know, it's fun, or you might get a really interesting result. And you know, like I'm always impressed by what, like, you know, some of the other guys, what they do. Like Eitan, Zana,
mm-hmm.
Nick Gronix, or is it Jindro or Gronix? I don't know. Jindro, John Sweeney, Aaron Lamonic, you know,
Naughty Dogs, right?
Naughty Dog guys, you know, and obviously, you know, Rob Rupel and those guys. Like, dude, they do so much awesome stuff, and they show so much of their process, and it, like, it's inspiring because the way they work, I don't work that way, and I want to try working that way, you know, and like, I don't know what kind of result I would get out of it because we all internalize and digest things so differently that, like, I'm always curious, like, dude, what if I tried painting that way? Like, obviously it's not going to look as good, but, you know, here's, man, let's just try it, see what I get out of it, and if it comes out great, dude, better.
Yeah, we had Maciej and Nick and Eitan joining us before, so guys that are watching, if you are curious about their process, go back to our channel and you can explore all sorts of videos there, and there are videos from Eitan, Nick, and Maciej. They're mind-blowing as well, so they're sharing their techniques, and you can see clearly what they do and can learn from them. They're awesome.
There's a lot of like things that I learned as well from even talking with some of the guys that I've got to meet and work with, Steve Messing. I have a huge, like, I gotta give him a huge props because he taught me a lot about just application of, you know, just lighting and techniques and stuff like that. And Dylan Cole is another big big guy that I definitely have to give a lot of props to as well. These guys are basically, they're masters of what they do. But the way they think, the way they problem solve using this tool and how they make images is just like, it's on another level, man. And it's just incredible that they're able to just share that process, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And it only adds to, you know, my image making experience. It's like, oh man, what if I use that when I'm painting? Or, you know, it kind of just gives you like all these different reasons and excuses to kind of try out different techniques.
Yeah, having these kind of teachers, so to speak, is just mind-blowing, right?
Yeah. So I'm like, man, when the whole Gumroad train started, dude, I was like, this is the best thing that can possibly happen.
Right. Exactly.
Or for many reasons, right? I mean, one, it's like, it's great for them to share and, you know, teach all these people who don't have access to schools. But also, it's like, dude, I've always wanted to know how these guys paint, and it's so cool to see, to finally see how they paint.
I love how you are coming up with like a really strong composition, even though it wasn't really suggested, like the pattern of light and shadow. It wasn't suggested by the Zorn's painting, so you're not sticking to one inspiration, creating on the go.
Like a different...
Yeah, it's just your twist to it.
Yeah, it's like oh, hey, that's kind of... Yeah, that kind of works. It's not the best, but I don't know, man. I'm still learning. I'm still making mistakes. But as long as you're learning, you know, I think that's the most important thing. Because not every piece that you do is going to be a gold mine, and you have to be okay with that. You have to be okay that, you know, everything that you try out is not going to always be as good as, you know, this piece or that piece. Or, you know what I mean? It's okay to be okay to make mistakes.
Yeah, because even when you are doing the mistakes, you are learning something, right?
Yeah.
You just tried, you just failed, but you learned another thing, and that's the thing.
Maybe that shape's better. I don't know, man. I haven't done a lot of this type of lighting scenario, so this is kind of like it's a little awkward for me to do.
But this is awesome, man. Already, so.
Maybe, I don't know, do something like that. Maybe a gun here.
Yes, yeah, strong directional light coming from the camera, kind of. Yeah.
Yeah.
It's not what you see all really often.
So this is something that I've been kind of trying to be a little bit more keen on is contrast, right? So when you have something hard edges, you want to contrast it by something soft, and having that contrast is just as good as like, it's like always related to food, and it's probably because everyone likes eating, but when you think about food, it's like if you got like a big hamburger and all you had was the bread. Yeah. It's not a hamburger. It's like, dude, it's just bread. That's gross, right? But if you had just the meat and bread, dude, that's disgusting too, because that's just...
It doesn't work.
It's all carbs, fat, and meat, dude. That's disgusting, right? So, you know, at a certain point, you're like, okay, I need some vegetables in here. I need, like, tomato to kind of balance what I'm digesting or what I'm eating to give it something, you know, to give it a better taste. And so there's so much contrast in even in ingredients in food. Right, and just like artwork, there's a lot of contrast in the ingredients, in the textures that we use, in the strokes that we make, and the edges that we showcase. It just makes your image, it makes the image making, or it makes your image look a lot more dynamic, for that matter.
Mm-hmm.
And Craig Mullins, I know he's like a big buff for that, of using contrast.
Yeah, I love his. Like pattern designs he does with his brush strokes, like the way he uniquely kind of designs the even brush strokes that may look sloppy, but they have some kind of a like pattern to them, and they're like different abstractions, and he uses so many of those that it's really cool.
See
how he creates small abstractions in the paintings, and then it kind of looks like something from the far, but when come up close, it's just like a dots scattered in a certain way, and you can see that it wasn't a custom brush, it was he painted like every single dot really dynamically, so it looks the way it looks. But yeah and I saw you borrowing from that as well. Like I saw parts of your painting that were impressed by that as well. Like,
oh dude,
you were doing similar things. Like for example, going for that really small brush but really hard one, and kind of like doing all sorts of things that I was seeing in Mullin paintings, and I was like, oh, that's the juice.
Thanks, man. I mean, I. Like, it's such a huge compliment when people are like, yo, this looks like a Craig Mullins. I'm like, really? like, oh my god, I achieved my life goal, but you know, it's not, it's like in my heart I'm like okay, I still have like, you know, 25,000 years, you know, to even reach a percentage of how good he is.
He's still human, though. You know, he's still human, but
yeah, he's still human.
Maybe.
He's maybe. I don't know.
Yeah.
that guy's like a Superman, dude. He's a monster.
Yeah. We can only see his paintings. That's too bad. Like, we can only see the final effect. We have no idea what's happening during the process. So, you never know. You never know. But, you know, it's something.
Yeah. Are there any, like,
there any
questions or anything that we should answer? Like, I don't know if, I feel like I've been, like, just babbling on this whole time.
No, it's all good. I mean, we are not picking questions until we run out of the juice during the session. So I guess this is a good point to start with the questions. And when you will feel like you're done with the demo, just let me know.
Okay.
So I will just... So guys, I know there were tons of questions coming up before. So if you have any, please retype them into the chat and I will pick them up, because tons of messages in the chat and scrolling and picking one will be just hell. I will try getting some. Okay.
Yeah, let's try, Wojtek, to pick up the questions. And I already, when we spoke to you, John, before the session, you just asked me about announcing something. So maybe it's the right time for doing it. Right
oh
now.
Yeah. I hope this isn't like, you know, cheesy or inappropriate. But James Pake and I are actually we're starting a school, and
awesome.
I don't know if for those of you guys who've been following or are a part of Brainstorm, it's a design group that we started, and it was actually heavily influenced by, you know, some of the groups that are already out there. Like obviously Level Up, Art Renegade, and I think some of the speed painting groups too. But we're starting Brainstorm, and it's going to be actually a physical school, and we're launching our first workshop on November 16th.
That's awesome.
And it's going to be a long workshop, dude. This is like, this feels like a full day. It starts at 10 a.m., ends at 7 p.m. we have two artists that are going to be showcasing and demoing, James Pake and Darren Quatch. Mm-hmm. And we're going to try to have these pop-up workshops at least maybe once a week or once every other week. And unfortunately, this is in California. The location is in Glendale. I will have all this stuff kind of ready, and I'll post it up on Facebook. But a upside to it is that we're going to try to record these workshops and have them available for Gumroad or streaming online.
Awesome, yeah. Nice.
That's a great idea.
You guys can have the benefit of watching the comfort of your own home. Obviously, the physical workshop is $185. It's a little bit on the pricey end, just because, like, you know, we're all physically there. We're going to provide lunch, and we're going to be with everyone for about a minimum of, like, 8 to 10 hours. So we're going to have QA session, we're going to have like portfolio review and all that jazz, but we'll be sure to have all that stuff available as well for those of you who are, you know, obviously not in California, or if you guys are too busy or too far away.
Awesome.
So, but yeah, thanks for allowing me to announce
no
that.
Worries. Man, that's no worries. It's like,
yeah,
awesome.
We will make sure to promote this on our group.
Yeah, we can actually post it on Level Up as well.
Yeah.
On the page. So.
Wow.
We have a lot of viewers and members from states.
Yeah.
So
wow, that's awesome, man.
Somebody will be around. These, yeah. Yeah, man, it's great to see like the thing that was just a Facebook group, I mean, with a great idea in mind, but it's actually, you know, taking place physically somewhere. That's really cool to see. We've been planning to do so as well with Level Up, something a little bit less like a workshop, but it's still an idea. But yeah, I know how much time it can consume and how much man hours it can consume to bring those things to life. So Yeah, that's great to see. So.
Yeah, we are definitely up for it. It's a great idea, man. So.
Yeah, too bad I'm not in California, goddammit. I repeat that myself every time. I see like a Naumann, Massive Black, now this. Yeah, awesome. Yeah, yeah, so at least we will have a Gumroad. So I'm waiting for those.
And yeah,
we should good luck with this. Yeah,
it's kind of like what, you know, I was saying before, like, you know, having these workshops is like it's our excuse to be able to hang out with the artists that we really enjoy hanging out with, mm-hmm. and just to kind of see their workflow, their kind of you know, their artistic trade secrets that they've developed for years, and just to kind of witness that, like, dude, that for us, like, we want to try to capture that, you know. And you guys have already been doing that for a while on Level Up, and it's like, man, we wanna try to get some of the other film guys or video game guys that work in California to try to do that too.
Yeah, that's great. There are so many names and people that are not in the spotlight, but they're doing such an amazing job that, you know, you are not able casually to reach out to them. So maybe these kind of workshops will bring those people to share their knowledge and.
Yeah, totally. Let's see here.
All right. Okay, so we got tons of questions actually.
Yeah. Let's start with picking up.
Okay.
Maybe I have a very good one.
Yeah.
How did you get into working for movies, and what would you suggest for people that want to work for the movies, John?
And how did I? Well, I started working in movies on my first job.
That's a good start, right?
There we go. On my first job. No, I'm sorry. That came out all. That came out wrong. You know. Actually, I got a lot of great opportunities from actually networking. And you know, Ben Proctor, who was one of the first guys that I met working in films, he was actually really generous enough to be able to reach out to me and give me the opportunity to work on Transformers. It actually initially started with my friend Robert Simmons. He was working on big projects before I did. And he kind of gave me a lead on that, and kind of mentioned my name to guys like Ben Proctor, who's working in the film industry. And here's the thing, you know, if you guys are out of the U.S. or you don't have direct contact, dude, feel free to, like, you know, reach out to these guys or reach out to anyone, any artist or anyone that's out working on the projects that you like, and try to network with them, right? Mm-hmm. But try to be not as intrusive, but try to be, you know, be curious, introduce yourself, be professional, and try to ask the right questions. I think I met Ben Proctor when I was around 22 years old, and so mm-hmm. I've always kind of, like, you know, try to keep in touch and, you know, exchange emails and all that stuff to ensure that, you know, like, I can, when I have questions to ask about the film industry, I can ask him. Mm-hmm. But as far as like you know, applying for film, it's so weird, dude. The way film works is, like, there's no application process. It's like you kind of have to do your homework and look at who worked on what movie, right? Mm-hmm. And I think that's where, like, you know, when you see credits of people's names or their work online, you know, I would contact them. I would ask them questions.
Yeah, reach out to them directly.
Yeah, reach out to those guys. I mean, those guys are the ones that are responsible for you know, a lot of the images that you see on screen.
Mm-hmm. Another question. Do you have a story of your darkest moment when you're trying to learn?
My darkest moment.
Yeah, I would say, like, these points when you don't see the light at the end of the tunnel, and you want it so bad, but you cannot. I mean, you probably got some. So maybe any advice of getting out of that, like.
Yeah. Here's the thing. I'm sure. I hope this resonates with those of you. Art does not come easily, right? But with hard work and perseverance, you can make it happen. it sounds super cheesy. I'm like embarrassed to say that, but when I started out, I had no idea what the fuck I was doing, dude. I had no idea. I was going to community college. I was embarrassed to say, you know, that I was going to a community college. It wasn't even a real college at the time. But I knew that I had to strive to try to get to the end of the tunnel, to see that light. And you know, all I can say is, if you love it enough, you'll do whatever you can to allocate time for it, right? Mm-hmm. To really dedicate the appropriate time, to reach out to those that know a little bit more about it as well, whether it's a professional or whether it's a friend, to see if they can help you out, or if they can give you advice on how to get better and this and that. I thought, you know, going to Art Center, I had so much high expectation for getting better as an artist, but you know what? That's just like one step.
Yeah, exactly.
Like, I think learning in general, don't expect people to hold your hands. Like, you have to be not afraid of working hard.
Mm-hmm.
Most importantly, you have to not be afraid of fucking up. You know, because it's gonna happen. It's a constant trial and error. It's like you'll never get things on the first try. And I never did. I feel like the first 5 to 6 years of my education, I was just constantly stumbling.
Mm-hmm.
Constantly trying to figure out, like, you know, what I was gonna do with my education, what I was gonna do with, you know, how do I get a job? You know what I mean? Like, all these questions kind of come into your brain, and you know what? In time, things will happen. But you have to not be afraid of working hard.
Yeah.
And here's another thing too, like, I had a really good friend who wanted to become a musician, and he was so disappointed. He was like, dude, I didn't get into music school, I didn't get to do this and that. And I was like, dude, why not? How come it didn't happen for you? He was like, I don't know, man. It's just not for me. Maybe I just don't have what it takes. And I asked him, I was like, well, hey, dude, did you practice today? Like, you know, what did you do to prepare yourself? He's like, no, I didn't. I was like, oh, okay, well, what about yesterday? Did you, how many hours did you get, you know, play or sing, or, you know, like, how much practice or time did you put into it yesterday? And he was like, you know, maybe like 20 minutes, 30 minutes. I was just thinking to myself, I'm like, dude, I think that's where your problem lies, is that you're not putting enough time. You're not giving yourself enough time, mm-hmm. to really devote to this, you know, to really get into this. And, you know, art's the same exact way, man. It really is. It's like, you have to really, if you want to be serious about it, you got to put in the time.
Yeah.
And I know it's difficult for some people out there, because they have families and all that stuff, but you know what? Like, if you have time to be on Facebook or be on YouTube and, like, you know, peruse around, then you definitely have time. You can make time to do art. You can make time to practice. To model and do all that stuff.
Yeah, it comes down to almost every genre of art or anything in our lives. And no pain, no gain, by the way. So
there's another question coming from Zach. You mentioned Art Center as being great for you. In fact, that you met friends, learned from them, gained connections, etc. Would you recommend it? I'm 18 and I'm from Canada.
Mm-hmm.
Hey, Zach. I think Art Center is a great place to jumpstart an education, but nowadays there's so many different schools and institutions and programs that are being offered. Even schools like Concept Design Academy, which is unaccredited, they have like the best teachers there, you know, excluding me. I was teaching there briefly, but you know, they have like James Paik, they have Kevin Chen, they have like all these awesome guys that are teaching there, and you know, it's go where the education is, you know. Mm-hmm. What I learned at Art Center was I learned how to be more disciplined, right? Because, I mean, dude, I come from a really shitty academic background. I have no discipline. I suck ass at math. I suck ass at, like, English. I was horrible in science. Like, I barely did my homework, man. I was just horrible. And so Art Center for me was a really, you know, it was a good kick in the butt. And that was the experience that I took from it. And so, you know, answer your question, I would go to Art Center if you love Art Center and you want to be an alumni at Art Center. But as far as connection and as far as education goes, you can get that anywhere.
There you go. What I just posted the link to Concept Design Academy website on our event page if you want to check it out. Darek, you were about to ask something.
I just want to ask about the projects, the handling them in the same time when you are having a lot of proposals, and how do you deal with, you know, with the time, with everything, and going with the projects and doing the high quality content, and how do you deal with the proposals when it's too much for you?
I think we had a conversation about that before,
yeah.
Right? We started.
Yeah.
Let's see here. When you get out of school, like everyone's hungry, right? You're so excited to just work on anything and everything. So I became yes man. Like, I did everything. Like, any time a job came in, I was like, yes, I will do it. And they would ask me, oh, can you do 40 hours for us? Yes, I will do it. And it got to a point where I said yes to everything, and I had about six projects or six clients I was juggling. And it's impossible. You do six times 40, that's 240 hours of work that they demand. You know what happened at that very moment? I found out that, oh my God, I totally shot myself in the foot, and I have a limit. What happened was I basically failed, and I failed all those jobs. I did the worst work that you can possibly think about. And you start to understand and you start to know where your limits lie. And so I would say, you know, as far as managing, do things that are at a comfortable pace for you, but do things where you can manage a good pace, a good time frame for you to produce work that you're proud of, right? Because it will show through as you're you know, working on those projects, and those clients will come back and they'll want to work with you because you did such an exceptional job.
Mm-hmm. So basically, just make a decision smart, right?
Yeah. I mean, and here's the thing, guys. I'm not saying don't take those jobs. You know, take everything that I said today with a grain of salt. But I think you know, give it a shot. Learn your mistakes. Try it out. Know where your limitations lie. You know, because you know some people they love juggling 20 projects at once. Mm-hmm. They get a high from it. You know, they get really excited. Other people, you know, they're kind of like, dude, I can't do that. That's insane. Mm-hmm. And I'm more like that. I didn't perform so well under that kind of pressure. And so I had to really, you know, slow down and just take fewer jobs, but do those jobs, you know, at a high caliber where I was extremely proud of doing those jobs. Hope that made sense. I don't know.
Yeah, definitely. It's like you have to remember about yourself, your you know, your health, your family, everything that surrounds you, and make the decision that really fits to your, you know, expectations as well. Because you are not a machine. You are not here to only work and work all the time.
Yeah, exactly.
Unfortunately, Jonas today isn't with us. I mean, he tried to join, but he's in a different country now, and he's losing internet connection. And so he just wanted to say hi and say sorry that he couldn't join. Yeah, too bad. I mean, he says everything will be fine next week, and it will be a pretty big session, our 50th session. Crazy. How many emails we did already? There's plenty of content. I guess it's over 150 hours now.
Oh wow, That's kick-ass, man.
Yeah, exactly. And it's not because of us directly. It's because of all the artists that committed to it, and I'm really
because of you, guests.
Yeah, that's awesome. Okay, so you're introducing some color variation in the light areas. So, what's your
My thought process is like before it felt really flat and muted. And keep in mind, like when I'm doing these sketches, guys, I'm still trying to figure things out. And I think the relationship when I look at Zorn's work, obviously when I bring this up, it's gonna be depressing. It's so good. But it's like look at the range of color, the contrast, and also the temperatures. He has so much nice warm and cool areas right here, and that's all balanced out too. That's interesting. Like if you think about
how saturated it is, right?
Yeah, it's like, dude, this is large, warm. Right? Mm-hmm. And then these cool areas are here, the white. That's all, small, medium size, it's a small cools, right?
Mm-hmm.
And please forgive me, I'm doing this like on the fly. I don't even know what I'm talking about sometimes.
Yeah, these are just notes, observations, right?
And then like, even in areas here, these are neutrals, right? They're kind of like not really cold, they're not really warm, but they're neutral zones, and these are medium shapes. And so I find that like even these guys, when they're painting, they've thought about the distribution of not only values, not only colors, but also temperatures. You know what I mean? Because when you look at this painting, you're like, dude, this is a really red room. At first, you're like, holy shit, why is this girl bleeding everywhere? Or what is this red stuff? But it's just like these accents, and that's what makes this illustration really powerful. It has that nice graphic read. So my intention is, can I implement some of that in here? I don't know. I hope to
enrich actual the palette, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, exactly.
Variations. Yeah.
Okay, let me get another question. For a game artist student who's not sure of what job she wants to do, what would you advise her to work on first? Studies anatomy, composition, color, perspective, landscapes.
Or
I guess you answered that already, but
could you repeat that again for a game artist?
Yeah, for a game art student. So I guess it's just a course that girl is taking, and
I would say like. What to study first? I would say maybe it's good to study first, like what it is that you want to get in your portfolio. Whether you want to be a character designer or whether you want to be an environment artist. And then just kind of go from there. Because you want your portfolio to be predominantly what you want to do on a full-time job, right? And let that kind of dictate, the focus of your education. Let that kind of dictate the type of classes that you need to take. Don't feel obligated to take everything at once. Take things in small increments.
Yeah, that's great advice. There you go. There's a cool question. How do you keep yourself motivated when you are working on a painting and it's not working out?
Oh man,
ah.
So many sad days, but most of my days are sad. what keeps me motivated is nothing is impossible, right? Like there's if there's a way, then I mean you'll find you can find a way. I mean things will just probably take longer than expected, but when I try to like when my paintings aren't working, I won't continue to paint because putting more time and energy into it won't resolve my issues. I'll actually stop and take a break. Like right now, I should probably stop because I don't know. I'm just kind of what they call licking.
Okay.
It's kind of like I'm just putting marks down without really thinking about it.
Okay.
It's good to step away, and it's good to look at other reference other artists. And mm-hmm. I'll look at you know Zorn, or I'll look at Craig Mullins, or some of my favorite artists, and kind of look at like you know, damn, like look at the treatment of that. Look at the lighting on that cheekbone. Look at the colors on that. Like, I don't have that in my painting. And just kind of take a step back to analyze, to think about it, and then go back on your painting with the fresh perspective.
That's cool.
And I think it's very healthy to do that occasionally, especially if you're trying to learn something from it, you know? Granted, you know, for some of you guys that are professionals, it's like, dude, yeah, you got the pressure of time. You just got to get things done. I get it. But, you know, unfortunately, when you do that to yourself, you're not learning how to become a better artist. You're just learning how to become more efficient.
Mm-hmm.
Right? So all these decision makings, like, you know, lighting, color, and all that stuff, like, you just have to take a step back, and you got to really give yourself, allow the time to figure out what's going to make your image better or what's going to make it more successful.
Mm-hmm. Awesome. So what about the things besides the art? Like, do you have another hobby, or you are just, you know, doing some sport for stressing out? How do you...
Well, I used to play a lot of basketball. I mean, I'm so out of shape now. But nowadays, you know, for kind of relaxation and stuff, I'll probably play... You know, I'm still a big, you know, nerd for games. So I love playing Dota. Dota is like my jam, dude. I would play that for hours if I could. But, you know, it's like I don't want to just do only... you know, play games. Like, I'll give myself a task where I'll say, okay, in order for me to play Dota, I have to finish at least, you know, one painting today, or I have to finish, you know, this design by whatever time, and then I'm allowed to do one game. It's a little like kind of Asian-y, for example. It's like, it's very like have to do your homework before you play, okay? It's like, I don't want to be like racist against my own people, but it really is. It's like, it's kind of like, it gives me a reason to kind of stick with what I'm doing, to kind of get it to a certain point before, you know, I take the break.
Yeah, it's like treating yourself with a break.
Yeah, exactly. You want to treat yourself. Otherwise, dude, I'm going to be playing Dota for, I'll do that for hours, you know, and I'll never get good at drawing.
Yeah.
But, you know, I love playing games that will, you know, mentally stimulate you, and, you know, you got to do things that are going to, you know, stimulate you in both, you know, physical way. Maybe playing sports will mm-hmm. definitely give you that edge. Playing games will give you a nice, like, you know, mental break from thinking about art all day, and you got to think about, like, you know, gameplay or story or whatever. And, you know, everyone kind of has their, you know, go-to for, you know, escaping, you know, for feeling like you're always doing work.
Mm-hmm.
Great. All right. So we are starting to get close to 3 hours, and I think it's time to wrap up.
Okay.
As you said, you feel like you're going circles with this piece, so maybe you will be more comfortable working on it maybe later. If you would like to share the process with us, that would be great, like what you did after, if you want to finish it off. So that was just a really great and insightful dive into your process and workflow. So thank you so much. Thank you so much for that from like all the viewers are watching. And guys, if you like what we are doing, please subscribe to our channel. And thank you, John. That was awesome.
Thank you, guys.
Amazing. Thanks, man, for joining us and sharing your knowledge, your road that you had to get as a concept artist, and your past, and your demo that you finally started doing, and it turned out great. Yeah, if you guys enjoy, please subscribe to Level Up channel, and stay tuned, because we are going to announce a next guest that is probably... that's not probably, it's a huge guest, so you'll definitely enjoy, and once again...
Make sure to find John on Facebook,
definitely. Of
follow
course.
His work, and we'll post more info about the workshop, Brainstorm Workshop in California, so stay tuned for that as well.
Awesome.
And, awesome times, man.
Thanks, guys.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you so much for your time.
Yeah, see you guys next week, then.
Yeah, bye-bye. Hey, hey.
Bye.
Darek, you sound so tired.